Brexiteer MP Desmond Swan gave a shocking answer when challenged about the government's chaotic handling of Brexit negotiations. Channel 4 News presenter Krishnan Gurumurthy told Mr. Swain it was a disaster and a farce. The British government had failed to unite Parliament on a common strategy to leave the European Union. The New Forest West MP said, "Well, blame the voters because they elected the Parliament. The reality is this. We have to work through that and find a way of honoring the decision that the voters made without joining some sort of suicide squad that wrecks the whole thing." Mr. Gurumurthy appeared dumbfounded by his statement, saying the Brexiteer seemed to be suggesting that stupid voters have elected stupid MPs. But Mr. Swain rejected the claim, "That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying people voted the way that they voted and elected the parliament that they voted for. The reality is that the Prime Minister is giving leadership to try and find the deal, and I'm saying that like-minded colleagues, whatever their own particular preference with respect to Brexit is, need to clearly think what is the best possibility of honoring the decision the people made." Prime Minister Theresa May has been fending off criticism over her latest Brexit white paper, securing a narrow victory in Parliament for her customs bill. The Prime Minister caved into demands from Brexiteer rebels following a string of frontbench resignations and a threat of rebellion from 80 MPs over the bill. To avoid a revolt from the backbenches, Mrs. May accepted four amendments hardening her Brexit offer to Brussels. She accepted the amendments after talks with Jacob Rees-Mogg and Sir Bernard Jenkin, leading figures in the backbench European Research Group, ERG. The amendments were tabled by the pair along with former Cabinet Minister Priti Patel and Diane Dunn. Appearing on the late-night political show, the LCB broadcaster, described as always the most keen Brexiteer by BBC presenter Evan Davis, heavily criticized the 12-point plan which sets out Britain's future relationship with Brussels. Mr. Dale said, "This is Brexit in name only, isn't it? I've obviously looked on Twitter tonight and seen the reaction of a lot of Tories, ordinary Tory party members, and that loud sound you hear in the background is them ripping their membership cards up. They aren't impressed by this." The political commentator continued by saying he did not see the outcome happening and explained all the ministers siding with Theresa May really shocked him. He then joked, "But let's see, they could all be getting their ministerial card home and then resigning in the morning." When asked by presenter Evan Davis where the public will land on the soft Brexit plan, he immediately responded, "I will tell you what the public think because I speak to them for 3 hours every day on the radio. A lot of them are saying that if Theresa May does not go through with a realistic Brexit, not a Brexit in name only, many of us will not only never vote Conservative again. We will never vote again. And this is the problem. Many of them are going to feel betrayed by this." The joint statement signed at Chequers by the Prime Minister and all her cabinet ministers yesterday put forward a plan for an economic and security partnership with the European Union. The plan, a close regulatory alignment with the bitter bloc single market for British exports, is a firm push towards a Brexit end state that looks very much like Norway. However, Mr. Dale also claimed the blueprint will be rejected, likely resulting in a no-deal Brexit. He told Mr. Davis, "The European reaction to the blueprint is going to be fascinating. What I predict." The LBC radio presenter rejected the idea that Brexit would doom the UK and called for a more measured response to leaving the EU. He said, "It's just as it was with the Millennium Bug. It was almost word for word what you're reading now. As we ticked over from the last second of 1999 to the first second of 2000, they said aircraft won't be able to take off, your bank accounts will be wiped out, businesses will lose all their money, traffic lights won't work, power will go off, the national grid will stop working. It was as bad as that. But guess what? None of it happened. As with most things in life, Brexit is not going to be as great as those who heralded a dance to the side of a red bus. And it's not going to be as bad as those who go around as if they're Private Fraser from Dad's Army saying, "We're all doomed." As with most things in this world, it will be somewhere in the middle. The comments follow Lord Mandelson, who claimed he is confident Theresa May will promise a second referendum in order to untie her hands from the BRICS extremists who are holding her hostage. The Remainer pair believes the Prime Minister will get a deal from the EU, win a vote in Parliament, and then give the British people a vote on the final outcome. He told Sky News, "We are light years away from what people expected or were promised at the time of the referendum. The whole negotiation over the last 2 years has been a complete shambles. Not surprisingly, people are disillusioned. For many, that disillusionment has turned to anger, and far from reuniting the country, the divisions within the government and the cabinet, within the parties, between the parties and in the country as a whole. Those divisions are as great as any, and the only way forward for Mrs. May is to continue the negotiation and put the best deal she can find to a people's vote. The only way to give democratic legitimacy to the final deal and to get approval is to put it to such a vote. The people now want to make an informed judgment and choice between what is on offer and the benefits we already had in the European Union. If she promises a people's vote, it will strengthen her hand against the BRICS extremists in her own party. She has got to turn round to them and say, what I negotiate has to pass muster and gain the support of the British people, so untie my hands, let me negotiate properly, because you are going to face a public vote at the end of the day." Unless she can say that to them, they are going to continue. The former International Development Secretary vowed she will fight Theresa May's Brexit white paper agreed at Chequers, as the new soft Brexit stance does not reflect her party's manifesto, she claimed. Speaking on BBC Westminster Hour, the Tory Brexiteer said she will encourage debates and arguments in Parliament today in an attempt to vote down the Prime Minister's proposals. She said, "We're speaking about an even playing field with the European Union, and of course that has always been part of the premise about withdrawing from the European Union. We also have to remember that the white paper is our opening position in the negotiations and could also be diluted down as we progress in the negotiations with the European Union. Quite frankly, their track record demonstrates that as well. I think it's important to have the debate and the discussion and have the arguments actually and put the case forward. We are asking for change, we're not going to ignore that point. We are asking for change. We have been critical of the white paper. It has many other flaws in there as well, around our independence, our ability to undertake free trade agreements. We'll have to see what happens, but I think it is important that we have this debate. This is a debate not just within the parliamentary parties, it's a debate across the country. The British public voted to leave, and of course our Prime Minister and the Conservative Party stood on the manifesto last year that was very clear about the way in which we were going to leave the European Union. Quite frankly, we are not in that space anymore. Things have changed in the perspective that has been put forward since the Chequers agreement and the white paper. It's very different from the Mansion House speech and all the other speeches that have been given by the Prime Minister and by members of the government. Jacob Rees-Mogg, who chairs the European Research Group, ERG, of Tory Eurosceptics, has laid down 4 amendments to the government's customs bill, which MPs could be asked to vote on next week. The amendments were lodged today, and Priti Patel, the former cabinet minister, has to sign them alongside Marcus Fyshe, John Redwood, Bernard Jenkin and Craig McKinlay. It is highly unlikely Labour would support Mr. Rees-Mogg and the Brexiteers on the Tory backbenchers, but it would be the first significant test of strength for her Brexit critics. One of the amendments, if passed, will prohibit the UK collecting tax or duties on another territory without reciprocity. This would cause a serious headache for Downing Street as it would block the current proposal of a... Speaking on his talk radio show, Brexiteer Mr. Young claimed having a second Brexit referendum would betray all the Britons who took part in the June 2016 vote. Mr. Young told the co-founder of the People's Vote campaign, his call for a second vote was a mere attempt to have as many referenda as needed until Remainers got the result they wanted. The radio host said, "When we had the EU referendum 2 years ago, it wasn't a provisional referendum. It wasn't a referendum with a view to then having another referendum. It was a definitive in or out choice." Even people on the Remain side said, "If you vote leave, we will leave. If you vote to stay, we will stay." They said this is going to be decided by this vote. And people who voted on that basis, they understood they were being asked a yes or no question and asked to give a definitive answer. And the question wouldn't then be revisited. Wouldn't you be betraying all the people who voted in that referendum, and particularly those who voted to leave in huge numbers, if you said, "Actually, we didn't get the result we want, so let's get another referendum," and then keep on having referendums until we get the result we want? Mr. Arthur attempted to justify his position, claiming many Brexiteers were already in favor of a second vote even before the result of the first EU referendum. He said, "It's not about having referendums forever. I don't think anyone is suggesting that. I think what we are saying is, yes, at the time in 2016 a lot of people did say this would be a definitive vote, but not everyone. There were significant Brexiteers at the time saying, actually, if there is a referendum now, there should be another referendum after the culmination of the negotiation period in order to sign, seal and deliver it. But ultimately, when the facts change, people should be entitled to change their mind. If the government were to put together a deal that somehow could get through Parliament and that has the support of the European Union, then I don't think Brexiteers should have any worry in saying, okay, let the public just rubber stamp the decision. But if the public feels differently, which I suspect that they do and will, then I think it's right that the people should have the right to change their mind." But Mr. Young brilliantly hit back at the Remainer and mocked his position with a hilarious comment. Former Brexit Minister Steve Baker resigned from the Department for Exiting the European Union, following Theresa May's Chequers meeting on Friday, in which the Cabinet agreed on a Brexit position. On Sunday evening, David Davis stepped down from his as Brexit Secretary, and on Monday afternoon, former Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson also resigned from the Cabinet. Speaking on BBC's Daily Politics, Mr. Baker warned about the prospect of allowing Jeremy Corbyn's Labour Party into power. He said, "We have talked about the party's unity. I think anyone can look back at the way I handled chairing Conservatives for Britain. One of the reasons I did it, and one of the ways I did it, was to try to keep the Conservative Party together during that period. The first interview I did was with Damian Green on this program. We came in friends and we went out friends. I hope and expect that we can get through whatever difficulties lie ahead and keep Conservative Party together. No one should be in any doubt that the real existential threat to prosperity in this country is John McDonnell and Jeremy Corbyn's Labour Party." The Prime Minister faced the threat of a vote on her future after she met with her party's backbench 1922 committee on Monday evening. Theresa May appeared to have headed off the threat of a potential threat to her leadership and is thought to have used the meeting to urge MPs to back her, or risk hard-left Labour leader Mr. Corbyn seizing power. Sir Graham Brady declined to comment on whether he had received any letters from MPs calling for a no-confidence vote in Mrs. May. He said, "It would be entirely improper ever to comment in any way on that subject, because inevitably a commentary could influence the course of events. asked if Mrs. May would fight any attempt to remove her through a vote of no confidence, a senior Downing Street source said, yes. It comes as the former Foreign Secretary Mr. Johnson claims his Brexit dream is dying in his scathing resignation letter. Mr. Johnson wrote, Brexit should be about opportunity and hope. It should be a chance to do things differently, to be more nimble and dynamic, and to maximize the particular county lines. Gangs exploit children as young as 12 to traffic drugs such as heroin and crack cocaine, using dedicated mobile phones. The gangsters travel across the country and target drug users in smaller towns using threats and violence to force people to work for them from their own homes, hence the term cuckoo. Now Derbyshire police have revealed that in the Midlands town of Swidlincote they have made 80 drug-related arrests in just 18 months as pushers are flown in to ply their trade from as far away as London. Swidlincote, a former mining town with a population of 32,000, has been picked as a prime location by the gangs because of easy access to Nottingham and Birmingham. Dealers brought in from outside the area have been making two-for-one offers or peddling the substances free in exchange for an address from which to sell drugs in the town. The local dealers, who are predominantly teenagers, are hired by big city drug barons to work for them. So far 23 addresses in the area have been cuckooed. PC Kevin Cassidy and PXO Amanda Beer are heading a task force gathering intelligence from locals. The duo, along with Acting Inspector Jason Cowley, also make safeguarding visits to victims known to have been targeted by the out-of-town dealers. PC Cassidy said, County lines is nothing more than a phone number, but the person who holds the number is in the cities. These city drug dealers will have a runner. The runner is normally a young person who does not come from an affluent background and sees the drug dealers have money. The drug dealers will tell them to go to Swidlincote. They either go to a drug user's address or a vulnerable person for maybe about 24 to 48 hours and then go back home. The runners approach the drug users, but they aren't users themselves. They have never really had police contact before and they don't really know what they have got themselves into. Teenagers as young as 17 have been arrested after they were caught dealing from a home in the town. So Beer said, it is like a 24/7 takeaway. Only last month George Lopes, 18, travelled from London to take over two addresses in the town. He was arrested and sent to a young offender institution for 3 years after admitting possession with intent to supply class A drugs. PC Cassidy said, George Lopes had no previous convictions but was arrested 3 times in the area. Another dealer, Nthambi Mkanda, 20, from Nottingham, was found with more than 70 wraps of class A drugs and arrested. He was sentenced to 45 months in a young offender institution. David Toombs, also from Nottingham, was sentenced to 30 months in a young offender institution after he was found armed with a knife and more than 70 wraps of class A drugs in the nearby village of Newhall. Lopes, Mkanda and Toombs were all runners recruited by a city dealer to travel to Swidlincote. It is not yet known how the dealers come to have the phone numbers of local people, but detectives believe it is often through connections made in prison. While it is often drug users who are targeted, police are finding that vulnerable people are also falling victim to the cuckoo dealers. For some it is company. Girls selling sex will know of old, may be lonely, men on their own and give the runners their addresses in exchange for drugs. Very often the girls selling sex are drug users themselves, PC Cassidy said. While Derbyshire police are executing warrants, the Swidlincote team of officers try to ensure that previous victims are safe. We regularly visit a person who has been previously cuckooed and make sure they have the support they need. Us being there is a deterrent, but also helps with gathering intelligence, explained Xobir. Police have made arrests at more than 20 addresses where the offender is from out of town and dealing drugs. Arrests have been made at some of these addresses on more than one occasion. As a warning to locals, Xobir said, be aware of your neighbors. If there is a change in their behavior or activity, maybe they would have let you in their home before, but now say they are going out. Or you see people going in and out frequently who don't live there. They are normally out on the street for as little as 30 to 40 seconds. Last October, Anti-Slavery Commissioner Kevin Hyland said the extent of county lines exploitation was only slowly being recognized. We're waking up to it, he said. Are we fully awake to it yet? Probably not, but we are starting to be. He says tackling the problem will require a change in the psyche of the police and other authorities, to see young drugs traffickers as victims, not criminals. Sarah Newton, Minister for Crime, Safeguarding and Vulnerability, said that, as well as new funding, the government had taken measures including passing legislation to allow police to shut down the phone lines. Brexiteer MP Craig McKinley warned Theresa May she should reset her Brexit strategy to her original plans or face the loss of trust from MPs and voters. The Prime Minister has been facing increasing pressure from Brexit-backing backbenchers to Chancellor withdrawal blueprint to ensure Britain puts an end to all current arrangement with the European Union. Speaking exclusively to Express.co.uk, the South Thanet MP said, she needs to reset back about 18 months to those lofty ideals we heard at Lancaster House last year. That was a proper Brexit. That satisfied the parliamentary party, it satisfied parliament, I think it satisfied the nation. She's going to have to revisit this white paper. The Brexit white paper set out plans for Britain to agree to a common rulebook of standards for food and goods and to maintain frictionless borders with the bloc. Brexiteers have criticized the proposal, claiming the creation of a free trade area would keep the country too close to Brussels, failing to deliver on the demands of Leave voters. Mr. McKinley reported his constituents have expressed dissatisfaction with the latest blueprint as it does not pass the sniff test. He continued, I have been around my constituency asking people what they think of it, what they read about it. To them, it just doesn't pass the sniff test. It doesn't pass the sniff test of this being a proper Brexit. We remain attached to too many vestiges of the EU, which is exactly what people were voting against. That was the customs union and the single market. The Tory MP suggested that unless changed, the white paper would have a damaging effect on the Conservative paper and urged Mrs. May to reconsider her position. The cabinet already suffered severe losses as leading Brexiteers David Davis and Boris Johnson quit their posts in protest. He added, we can play it up in tricksy language that the white paper does deliver exit from the customs union and the single market, but when you really get down to the fabric of how this would work, it's pretty much a softer backdoor. It needs to be changed, and I think it will be changed because the parliamentary arithmetic is not there, and this is having a damaging effect on the Conservative Party. If you go out to the associations, they're not happy with what they are reading so far. This is really an important matter for the Conservative Party, important for the country as well. Mr. McKinley concluded, the worst thing we can have is the electorate thinking we did something. We had that power given to us in our hands for the referendum, and here they are, the Westminster politicians, watering that down, delivering something different. This is a real fundamental matter of trust. Mrs. May defended her proposals, claiming the government wanted to deliver Brexit to Leave voters while ensuring British jobs are protected. She said, what we are doing is putting forward a plan that sets what we want to deliver on the vote of the British people, but does so in a way that protects jobs. We still want to be able to trade. We still want to be able to sell out goods to people in Europe and for them to be able to see their goods to us. We're doing that in a way that protects jobs here in the UK. Michael Portillo let it rip at the government over their latest post-Brexit trade plans, suggesting their strategy would either transform Britain into a colony or force the country to stay in the European Union. The Prime Minister put forward a proposal that would see the country maintain its close trading ties through a free trade area controlled by a common rule book dictated in Brussels. The This Week contributor said, following the publication of the proposals that were passed by the cabinet, sort of, last Friday it kind of just dawned on me, I think for the first time, that from where we are now, with all the opportunities that have been missed, there are only two possible outcomes. One is a non-Brexit Brexit, and the other is remain a member of the European Union. Either to be a colony of the European Union or to be a member of the European Union. Said to be at the core of the UK's proposal, the free trade area between the UK and EU also ensures frictionless travel of goods by taking away the tariff burden on all by 4% of goods. Britain has promised to sign up to a common rulebook of regulations with Brussels. This would mean the country would adhere to the bloc's customs code for goods. Mr. Portillo continued, I think, as that dawns on people, there's going to be a lot of anger. Personally, I have arrived at the view that it is better to even have an ultra-soft Brexit than to remain a member. At least we get out of the common fisheries policy or the common agricultural policy. Many Brexiteers will be also thinking that maybe, whatever they might wish in this world, it's either going to be a very soft Brexit or there's going to be no Brexit at all. He added, I think this is the most dreadful betrayal, and if I had been a member of the cabinet, I would have been one of the ones who would have quit over the weekend. The release of the White Paper on July 12 sparked further chaos in the House of Commons as it became evident that copies of the document had not been made available to all MPs, despite the media having access since 9 a.m. As new Brexit Secretary Dominic Raab stood up to introduce it, shouts of complaint echoed out across the chamber and Speaker John Bercow suspended proceedings long enough for last-minute copies to make their way into ministers' hands. In an introduction to the White Paper, Mrs. May said the UK's negotiating position with the EU had evolved, in an approach that, she said, requires pragmatism and compromise from both sides. She added, this was the spirit in which my cabinet agreed a way forward at Chequers. The author claimed that despite the England World Cup defeat, the tournament was particularly welcomed in the context of Brexit and that it helped put Englishness on the show. Speaking on the BBC flagship programme, the author of The Road to Somewhere claimed it showed a different side to the UK. Mr. Goodhart said, the country has been very divided. So it is particularly welcomed in this context for us to find some collective object that we can get behind. The worldview post-Brexit was that we were a mean-spirited place, driven by this mean-faced English nationalism, spike in hate crime and all of that. So this is a very welcome shift of focus. When BBC presenter Evan Davis asked him what he makes of the World Cup in terms of unity and nationalism for the country, Mr. Goodhart claimed that no single sporting event or World Cup run hugely changes anything dramatically. But he acknowledged that Englishness was on show and that the World Cup changed how the quality was solely perceived as a white thing. Mr. Goodhart said, there is an analogy with Danny Boyle 2012, the Olympics. The way in which Britishness was on the show, kind of generous and open thing. The same thing has happened to Englishness in this World Cup. The author continued, it is true that historically ethnic minority Brits have tended to not identify with Englishness because it was seen as a white thing. But it has been a journey for quite some time. and particularly given the mixed race and black members of the squad, 11 out of 23, that does change the formula a bit. England played Croatia on Tuesday, and the match ended the Three Lions World Cup dream for this year. However, Gareth Southgate's charges were praised highly for a fine campaign. Supporters praised the manager for taking the squad so far. Speaking on talk radio, the former Secretary of State for Education claimed Theresa May's Brexit plan agreed at Chequers subverted the will of 17.4 million of British people who voted to leave the EU. Mr. Hafin argued a second referendum, proposed by arch-remainers as the alternative to the Prime Minister's Brexit plan, would turn the UK into a banana republic. The Conservative MP, who voted to remain in the June 2016 referendum, said a second vote on the issue would be entirely wrong. He said, "We've heard of fake news. I think a second referendum would be a fake referendum. It will be like almost becoming a banana republic. I voted remain, but I passionately believe that we have to do what the public voted for. 17 million people voted to leave, and in my constituency, 68% voted to leave, and they were really angry about the Chequers deal over the weekend. Just normal members of the public, not just Conservatives members, because they felt that it had subverted what they had voted for to actually leave the European Union. So I think a second referendum would be entirely wrong. I support the Prime Minister, but she's got to lead on this. She's got to recognize that the Chequers deal takes us backwards in terms of doing what the people have voted for." On Monday, former Secretary of State for Education Justine Greening claimed Theresa May's soft Brexit deal satisfies neither the Brexiteers nor the Remainers, making a second referendum on Brexit the only option available before going any further in the negotiations with the EU. Speaking on BBC News, she said, "When I talk to people who voted Remain in my constituency, they feel this means we have to abide by all the rules, but we're not sat around the table to influence them. They find it impossible that the Leavers themselves, who actually won the referendum, they're unhappy as well with this. And I understand why. They feel like this doesn't give Britain the clean break that they voted for. And I think we shouldn't ignore that, and it's clear that Parliament is stalemated and that's the situation." He said both Vienna and London need their bonds to remain very strong after Britain quits the European Union in March 2019. He was welcoming Theresa May to the Austrian capital after Brussels chief negotiator Michel Barnier delivered a hammer blow to the Prime Minister's white paper, effectively killing off her customs plan. Mr. Kurz emphasized the importance of concluding the withdrawal agreement in order for negotiators to move forward with their discussions on the future relationship. The Austrian leader said, "I think the negotiations are going quite well. I would like to thank you, Chief Negotiator Michel Barnier. With his work, we can be successful in finding a solution in October. We will support Michel Barnier, and I hope that we can find a way that after Brexit the relations between the UK and Austria, and the UK and the European Union, will be very strong, because I would say we both need that." His support for Mr. Barnier came after an EU source suggested German Chancellor Angela Merkel was becoming restless with stalled negotiations and wants to give heads of state the opportunity to work together to find a solution. "There is a sense of drift. It is time for leaders to have a serious discussion," the source said. Mr. Barnier dismissed the claim, insisting, "Anyone who wants to find a sliver of difference between my mandate and the leaders is wasting their time." An EU diplomat told Express.co.uk there was no division in the EU27's position and will continue to back Mr. Barnier in the negotiations. Despite the solidarity surrounding the Frenchman's position, Mrs. May will continue on her charm offensive round the continent as she hopes to win over EU leaders to her controversial Chequers plan. Speaking alongside Mr. Kurz, the Prime Minister said, "We are delivering on a vote of the British people. They chose to leave the EU and we will deliver that." The pair will hold a short discussion on Brexit, after which Mrs. May will meet with her Czech counterpart Andre Babiš before heading off for her summer holiday. After Mr. Barnier said the EU would not allow Britain to collect tariffs on behalf of Brussels, UK Brexiteers have been on the counter-offensive. Former Brexit Minister Steve Baker said, "Chequers was bound to be the beginning of the EU pushing the UK to the unacceptable combination of EE and customs union membership. On this road, eventually we will reach a fork between final capitulation or exit with no agreement." International Trade Secretary Liam Fox said if talks break down, Britain should leave the EU without a deal, not accepting any Article 50 extension. "To attempt to extend our membership even longer, many voters would regard as a complete betrayal by the political class." In an explosive interview inside the US Embassy in Brussels ahead of his visit to the UK, the US President said the London mayor has done a very bad job on terrorism. He told The Sun, "I think allowing millions and millions of people to come into Europe is very, very sad. I look at cities in Europe, and I can be specific if you'd like. You have a mayor who has done a terrible job in London. He has done a terrible job. Take a look at the terrorism that is taking place. Look at what is going on in London. London has been the victim of 4 terror attacks in the last year. These were at Westminster, London Bridge, Parsons Green Tube Station and Finsbury Park's Mosque." He added, "I think he has done a very bad job on terrorism. I think he has done a bad job on crime. If you look, all of the horrible things going on there, with all of the crime that is being brought in." Trump also revealed Sadiq Khan has shown the US a lack of respect after London City Hall, run by the London mayor, granted permission for a 6-meter inflatable of the US president, complete with nappy and man boobs, to fly over the Capitol during his visit. He said, "I think he has not been hospitable to a government that is very important. Now he might not like the current president, but I represent the United States. I also represent a lot of people in Europe, because a lot of people from Europe are in the United States." Trump clashed with Mr. Khan last year after a terrorist attacked people on London Bridge and Borough Market. The Republican firebrand mocked the mayor for his appeal to Londoners to stay calm. He tweeted, "At least 7 dead and 48 wounded in terror attack, and Mayor of London says there is no reason to be alarmed." Mr. Khan described the tweet as ill-informed. A source close to Mr. Khan said the Home Office is in charge of immigration policy for the heated feud was sparked by comments made by Irish Taoiseach Leo Varadkar, who told a cabinet meeting, "You can't take back your waters and then expect to take back other people's sky." The debate began when the British economist brilliantly pointed out that landing rights are reciprocal, insisting that if the UK, under a no-deal Brexit scenario, is unable to take off in EU airspace, then the rule should also apply to EU aviation companies. But Mr. Liss hit back and said, "What we are saying is that the EU will be a lot less affected by no deal than Britain would be." The British Influence Deputy Director added, "At the moment, our aviation is governed by the Single European Sky, the European Aviation Safety Agency, the Aviation Single Market. If you have no deal, you fall out of each one of those overnight." But the Brexiteer fired back and said, "Jonathan's whole animus is to try and massively undermine the bargaining position of his own country for some reason." The ND Hard Brexit think tank boss said, "I'm a traitor, yes. Confess that." The Economist said he hopes Mr. Liss is getting well paid, which infuriating the think tank boss who insisted the comment was below the belt. Mr. Halligan said, "Not at all. People need to know where you are coming from." In order to convey the notion that the UK has no choice but to accept staying in the single market and customs union, which is completely contrary to the vote on January 2016. He added, "There are countries outside the EU and outside the single market that are part of these pan-European aviation agreements. Countries across southeastern Europe, countries in the Balkans. The idea that an aviation superpower like the UK, where flights have multi-billion pound implications, both in terms of tourism, commerce and diplomacy, would be allowed to not fly because politicians are squabbling is ludicrous." Mr. Halligan continued to rubbish the claims and said, "If there is no agreement, if the politicians are so infantile that they can't sort it out, there will be memorandums of understanding signed that existing rules continue until new agreements are bought into place." The EU also released a 15-page document on Thursday outlining its preparations for a no-deal Brexit. EU officials say the document goes in depth into the fates of a number of industries such as air travel, but the Commission is still far away from providing an actual solution. To ensure planes can still fly between, showgoers jumped for their lives as a blue Toyota RAV4 automatic car smashed into a stage. No one was seriously injured in the drama at Burnham Market Flower Show in Norfolk last Saturday. Organizers were stunned to find the note on the car's dashboard after making sure the driver was okay. It read, "Key in ignition. Foot on brake. Start engine. Gear lever into D, foot off brake." Lawrence Rubin, 71, treasurer of Burnham Horticultural Society, said, "I was sitting in the marquee and suddenly I became aware that I'd been hit and things kept falling on top of me. I have got aches and pains and will be going for a CT scan. I am lucky to be alive." Flower Show Secretary Dr. Diana Black, 53, said, "It was an accident, but when I saw that note I started to feel angry. If you need written instructions, surely you shouldn't be driving. There could have been fatalities or serious injuries, but miraculously there weren't." Police Inspector Lou Provert said, "A traffic offense report." The Conservative backbencher Andrew Bridgen has said he has no faith that the Prime Minister is delivering the Brexit that we promised the British people and that her soft Brexit plan was hurting the country. Mr. Bridgen, the Conservative MP for Northwest Leicestershire, told Sky's Adam Bolton, "I want the Prime Minister to change her position on the Chequers plan, but she says she is not going to change her position. Therefore, I have no confidence in her proposals from Chequers and I have no confidence in the Prime Minister. What I think will happen is that those cabinet ministers who were bulldozed into supporting the Chequers proposal on Friday, the ones who haven't resigned will maintain their position. But I think at the first indication of further concessions to the European Union, there will be another round of resignations." Mr. Bridgen added, "I have no faith that the Prime Minister is delivering the Brexit that we promised the British people. It is really hurting us in the country." Mr. Bridgen wrote a letter of no confidence in the Prime Minister to the chairman of the Conservative Party's 1922 committee on Tuesday. It comes following a series of resignations in the government after Theresa May agreed a compromise on her Brexit model with her cabinet at Chequers last Friday. The resignations of Brexit Secretary David Davis and Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson came days after they approved Mrs. May's soft Brexit plan at Chequers. Mrs. May indicated the cabinet had agreed upon a collective position on its Brexit stance at the Chequers meeting on Friday and would seek a model similar to the single market for goods and the facilitated customs arrangement. The Prime Minister commented on the resolution stating, Today, in detailed discussions, the Cabinet has agreed our collective position for the future of our negotiations with the EU. Our proposal will create a UK/EU free trade area which establishes a common rule book for industrial goods and agricultural products. This maintains high standards in these areas, but we will also ensure that no new changes in the future take place without the approval of our Parliament. As a result, we avoid friction in terms of trade. Lord Mandelson claimed nationalism was not to be confused with patriotism as he launched his attack on Brexitremus. LBC host Ian Dale was enraged by the anti-Brexit rant, claiming it was an insult to the 17.4 million people who voted to leave the EU. He said, for Lord Mandelson to essentially say, of people who he calls Brextremists, of which he would probably include me, and this is a direct quote, are nationalists in the sense that they hate other countries and they hate foreigners, and that is what motivates them, that is what drives their behavior. He did actually say before that he was talking about the difference between nationalism and patriotism. He did respect some people voted the other way. I feel actually quite personally insulted by that. I don't know anyone that voted leave for those reasons. I don't know anyone that voted leave because they hate foreigners. I don't know anyone who voted leave because they are extreme nationalists. There may well be some that did. Just because I don't know them doesn't mean they don't exist. If you want another referendum, presumably your aim is to win people over from the other side of the argument, to win Brexiteers over to your side, to recognize what a disaster Brexit will be, and therefore you want them to vote the other way. Well, this is a very odd way of going about it, isn't it? To insult people's motives for voting the way that they did. During an interview with LBC, the former European Union Trade Commissioner argued he accepted the views of Leave voters, but then launched a scathing attack on so-called Brextremists. He said, nationalism, it's nationalism which is not to be confused with patriotism. Patriotism is love of your country, wanting to stand up for your country, wanting to serve the best interests of your country. Nationalism, on the other hand, is hatred of foreigners, and that's what they are. They are nationalists. They should not be, as I say, confused with patriots. He added, I feel I am patriotic, I want the best for Britain. It's why, incidentally, I voted Remain in the referendum, although I respect the contrary view of very many others. But these people, these Brextremists, they are not like that. They are nationalists in the sense that they hate other countries and they... Lord Richard Newby was outraged after the idea of a second referendum was belittled during a debate on Brexit, claiming that he knew better than a Brexiteer journalist. The leader of the Liberal Democrats in the Lords had been discussing the recent YouGov poll that showed a majority of Britons favoured a second referendum for the first time when he erupted in fury. The Remainer featured on talk radio with host Dan Wooten and Brexiteer journalist Patrick Christies, who reports for news website Westminster. Lord Newby fired back when Mr. Christies claimed that the YouGov poll was evidence of dismay with the government's handling of Brexit, rather than the referendum result. Mr. Christies agreed with Wooten, who told listeners that the poll was rubbish. The Brexiteer said, these polls need to be taken with a pinch of salt. They are a rebellion with the awful job that May is doing with Brexit, they are fed up. People like Richard, what they want a second vote on is an option between a no deal and Remain. That is why they are trying to force us into a no deal scenario. Lord Newby responded, we don't. That's untrue. Mr. Christies added, it is not untrue. You've spoken a lot, I'd like to speak now, thank you. The Remainer Lord hit back, I know what will happen better than you do, I believe. Earlier in the program, Lord Newby had told Wooten that it was hardly undemocratic to say people, rather than politicians, should have the final say on Brexit. The talk radio host attacked this idea. We have had a say. There was a campaign, there was a vote. I get it, you didn't like the result, in fact you hated the result, but what you are trying to do is so undemocratic. I can't get my head around it. The second referendum poll showed that 42% said there should be a referendum on the final Brexit terms, while 40% said there should not. Only 19% of people who voted for Brexit in 2016 said there should be one, while 66% of those who voted to stay in the EU said there should be one. Last week, new Brexit Secretary Dominic Raab warned a no-deal Brexit was possible if talks fall through. Nigel Farage has pledged to return as UKIP leader if Theresa May continues to pursue her Chequers proposal, which the Brexiteer has branded a betrayal of the referendum vote. The ardent Brexiteer, who left his position as UKIP leader following the referendum vote, has hinted at a return to frontline politics for a long time. However, the shock resignations from Brexit Secretary David Davis and Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson appear to have prompted Mr. Farage into this shock pledge. Speaking to listeners on his LBC phone-in show, the Brexiteer MEP issued a warning directed to Tory MPs who are sitting in marginal seats and have failed to back a true Brexit. He said, "I never thought I would say that again, but the government's sellout leaves me with no choice. The latest Brexit betrayal must be reversed." Mr. Farage pointed out that the tenure of Gerard Batten, the current leader of UKIP, will come to an end in March 2019, the same month when Article 50 ends. The MEP added, "Unless Brexit is back on track by then, I will have to seriously consider putting my name forward to return as UKIP leader. I can ensure any Conservatives listening to this, sitting in marginal seats, who are not prepared to honour the wishes of the electorate, I will make damn sure that you all lose your seats. There are millions of Conservative voters who are very unhappy indeed." The Brexit supporter also said that his return to Westminster politics rests on whether Mrs. May continues to pursue her Chequers agreement and if Article 50 is suspended or delayed. He reiterated this pledge in an article for the Daily Telegraph, writing, "I will have no choice but to resume campaigning in all parts of the United Kingdom." The Chequers sellout is, though, by far the most serious dereliction of duty of which Mrs. May is guilty to date. She clearly had no qualms over committing this latest Brexit stitch-up, believing her party would back her automatically. Will Jacob Rees-Mogg and the European Research Group have the guts to bring down this Prime Minister? I hope so. For it is obvious that as long as she remains at the helm, there will be no clean, democratic Brexit. Earlier in the day, Farage congratulated Mr. Davis for resigning and called on Mrs. May to go, accusing her of being duplicitous. The latest political bombshell follows a day of chaos for the government as Theresa May faced fury from party Brexiteers. There were concerns that Tory MPs, furious at the Brexit tactics, may demand a no-confidence vote. However, it is believed that Mrs. May has faced off any imminent threat of a coup. Conservative commentator Isabel Oakeshott had earlier tweeted at the opportunity for Mr. Farage to return to politics. She said, "Tory MPs are worrying about hemorrhaging support from Brexit voters and their constituents." A Conservative MP warned Prime Minister Theresa May that he would not sign up to her Brexit deal if the European Union were paying us, as Brexit Secretary David Davis resigned over the deal. Andrew Brigden, the Conservative MP for Northwest Leicestershire, told LBC's Tom Swarbrick, "Quite honestly, Tom, I wouldn't sign up to this deal if the EU were paying us. I am going to give the Prime Minister a chance on Monday night, We have got a meeting of the 1922 where the Prime Minister is going to address the party. I think it will be very stormy, and I have certainly got some questions for her and the cabinet, and we will see where it goes from there. This undermines our democracy and it badly damages the Prime Minister, and it is damaging our party. I'm not going to support it. He added, I think people like prominent members of the Leave campaign, like Mr. Gove and Mr. Johnson have got questions to answer. I'm not happy at all. I would like to hear what Mr. Johnson and Mr. Gove have to say for themselves, and there are others in the cabinet that are leading Brexiteers. They should have seen this off. This U-turn would be very damaging for the Prime Minister, and we need to avoid it. In Mr. Davis's official resignation letter, he said, the national interest requires a Secretary of State in my department that is an enthusiastic believer in your approach, and not merely a reluctant conscript. While I have been grateful to you for the opportunity to serve, it is with great regret that I tender my resignation from the cabinet with immediate effect. He stated that the current direction of Brexit policy would leave the UK in at best a weak negotiating position, and possibly an inescapable one. The Brexit Secretary's resignation delivered a devastating blow to Theresa May's premiership. His resignation was quickly followed by frustrated caller Bradley urged Nigel Farage to take over the Brexit talks from Theresa May, because EU negotiators are scared of him. The Leave voter expressed his anger at the leading Brexiteer for allegedly distancing himself from the negotiations with the European Union in the aftermath of the 2016 referendum. Speaking to Mr. Farage during his daily LBC radio show, Bradley said, I voted to Brexit, to come out. I agree with everything you said, the policies and the lot. What I'm most angry about, is I'm angry with you. You're the person that started this, quite rightly because I agree with you, but they have made a shambles of it. You've just made a comment about why don't someone stand up and, you know, put themselves on. You should be doing that. Just for the negotiations, they need you for the negotiations. The Brexit supporter claimed Mr. Farage would not put up with the rubbish of Brussels negotiators and suggested the British MEP hold a public vote during his show to let the people decide who should conduct the last phase of Brexit talks. Bradley continued, you are happy to sit here after leading this campaign or starting this campaign and watch Mrs. May and everybody else make a shamble of it. They look like idiots. Announce it on LBC, have a public vote. Who should lead the negotiations? Who are the European Union most scared of in this country? You are the last person they want to see because they know you are not going to take the rubbish. Mr. Farage revealed he offered his services to the Conservative Party following the referendum but was rebuked. He said, in the wake of the referendum, I spoke to several senior Tory Brexiteers as they were getting ready to put the new government together and then after Mrs. May had taken that position. I said to any of them if I can be of any use at all, I volunteer to do it. I wouldn't want paying, I would happily do it. And none of them would want to touch me. There was nothing I could do, I would have done if I had the chance, I promise you. The British MEP pledged to return to active politics unless the Prime Minister is able to deliver on the demands of Leave voters. Speaking after the publication of the latest Brexit white paper, Mr. Farage said, I see this woman, the Prime Minister, trying to overturn all of our achievements. If they don't get Mr. Roth, who is a member of the SPD at the German Parliament, insisted that the European Union was not seeking to punish Britain for voting to leave. Speaking after a meeting of the EU27 to decide its response to Theresa May's Brexit plan, he told reporters, "We are extremely aware of the current situation. Nobody wants to punish the British government or the British people, not at all. But at the end we are negotiating on the basis of the guidelines. Guidelines are no red lines, but we are committed to these guidelines for the next negotiations. Time is running out, the clock is ticking, and that's why I'm a little bit nervous. Michel Barnier, the EU's chief negotiator, welcomed the government's white paper on Brexit, but hinted that the bloc would seek further concessions from British negotiators. He said, "This document has opened the way to a constructive discussion leading to the political declaration on our future relationship. This white paper is the result of a very intense internal debate in the UK, a debate that was necessary, and I think we have all seen that this debate in the UK is not over yet." Mrs. May thrashed out her Brexit blueprint with cabinet ministers at a marathon Chequers meeting earlier this month. The plan, designed to kickstart stalled negotiations with the EU, sparked fury among Brexiteers as it would have locked the UK into a single standards model and a common rulebook for goods, effectively preventing Britain from adopting competing national standards. Brexit Secretary David Davis and Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson both resigned in protest at the proposals. His Royal Highness, unlike many England fans, remained calm and measured about his country's chances when asked about the semi-final game. Brian O'Driscoll, former rugby sports star, said, "I asked him, 'So, is football coming home?' He refused to say it. I think he just said he isn't as confident as everyone else about England winning. He said he won't say it because he doesn't want to jinx it." The former rugby player was at a British ambassador reception with his wife Amy Huberman, who was an actress starring in several popular Irish TV shows. Prince Harry spoke on stage at the event, where he made a humorous jibe towards his father, the Prince of Wales. The Duke of Sussex was thanking the British ambassador to Ireland, Robin Barnett, when he made the joke about Charles. He said, "As some of you may know, he, the ambassador, showed my father around his home city of Cork a couple of weeks ago." Prince Harry added, "So we are very grateful for you joining us here this evening as well. And also very nice to know he didn't bore you senseless." The Duke of Sussex arrived in Dublin as part of a two-day visit to the Irish capital with his wife Meghan. The trip marks their first overseas outing as a married couple. To conclude their trip, the royal couple will meet residents and visit organizations in Dublin that are an integral part of Irish identity. They will visit a Gaelic sports festival at the home of the Gaelic Athletic Association. In 1920, it was here where the Bloody Sunday massacre occurred, and it was previously visited by the Queen as part of a momentous trip in 2011. Prince Harry and Princess Meghan will also soak up Ireland's rich cultural history attending the Irish Emigration Museum, which explains the journeys of 10 million Irish people to countries around the world. The trip will not just focus on the past. The Prime Minister is pursuing her Chequers agreement as the UK negotiates with the EU, despite criticism from some hard Brexit MPs in her own party. Since Theresa May released her Brexit white paper, warnings have ramped up that the UK could cut ties with the EU without an agreement. Former Conservative leader, Iain Duncan Smith, has claimed the term "no deal" means nothing at all. He said, "The reality is that a no deal is not a no deal. In a sense, the term means nothing at all. What it's referring to is that we wouldn't reach a special arrangement around how we operate our trade, so there wouldn't be a special free trade arrangement, which is what the government is actually seeking at the moment. What it does mean is that there is a deal, and the deal is that we would leave under World Trade Organization terms, which the EU already operates under for all its trade outside the EU, as we do." By the way, The TO is a rules-based organization that also governs all the institutions that the EU has with regards to trade, such as the customs union. Mr. Duncan Smith added, "So when we are talking about no deal, we are talking about no special trade deal, but there will be a deal. Because the TO demands that the EU and any other country would have all of those schedules sorted out." LBC host Tom Swarbrick then asked the Conservative MP about warnings the UK is stockpiling blood and food in the event of a Brexit no deal. He replied, "Well, the word stockpile is a contentious point. The reality is that all down the years UK governments have made particular care that if there is a problem with something we always have reserves. This has happened time and time again. So this would not be anything particularly new." Speaking to Channel 5 News, the Prime Minister was asked about reports the UK is having to stockpile medicines and blood supplies in preparation for no deal. She said, "Well, far from being worried about preparations that we're making, I would say that people should take reassurance and comfort from the fact that the government is saying that we're in a negotiation working for a good deal. I believe we can get a good deal. But actually it's right that we say because we don't know what the outcome is going to be, we think it's going to be a good one, we're working for a good one but let's prepare for every eventuality." She added, "Look, this is not just about stockpiling that concept. What it is about making sure that we'll be able to continue to do things that are necessary once we've left the EU if we leave without a deal. Now I think people should take reassurance from the fact that this is a government that's saying you know what we're going to be responsible about this, we're going to be sensible about this, but while we're doing that we're going to work for a really good deal that's in the interests of people living here in the UK." Brexit Secretary Dominic Raab pointed out on Tuesday that there was a real risk of a no-deal Brexit and the UK needs to be ready. Speaking in the Commons, he said, "No deal is certainly a real risk, and as the time for the deal approaches, the only responsible thing." Brexit Health Alliance co-chair Niall Dixon warned Theresa May over the effects Brexit could have on medical supplies if the government fails to strike a deal with the European Union. Last week Health Secretary Matt Hancock announced the government was considering launching contingency plans to stock medicines to be prepared in case talks with Brussels fell through. Mr. Dixon welcomed the announcement, telling Channel 4 News healthcare providers should begin to set out plans to stockpile for 4 to 6 weeks. He said, "For us, it has to be the number one priority. For patients, this is a matter of life and death, therefore good planning and common sense can get us around this. I don't want people to start panicking because that's not the thing to do now, but it does mean the government has to start thinking about stockpiling, maybe 4 to 6 weeks supplies in some cases. It's certainly the case that NHS organizations must now start to look at their own supply chains. What drugs do they get? Which ones are they very reliant on Europe?" The former General Medical Council boss insisted the government should make sure NHS and other healthcare providers are prepared in case medicines flow is stopped because of the reliance the country has on EU chemicals. Mr. Dixon continued, "First point, which I think a lot of people don't understand, is just how dependent we are and how interdependent the whole healthcare supply chain is. Even for one drug, you can have chemicals that will cross 3 or 4 borders. Out of the UK every month, 45 million packs of medicines leave the UK to go to Europe and 35 million come the other way." He added, "It may be acceptable for cars to sit around in Calais for a week or so while things are sorted out. It's simply not acceptable for medicines. That's why planning is right." Regulatory agency chief Sir Michael Rollins warned yesterday a no-deal Brexit could put the country on track for insulin shortages. Nearly 4 million Britons are estimated to suffer from diabetes. Sir Michael claimed no company in the country produces insulin, and a no-deal Brexit could put supplies at risk. Sir Michael said, "We make no insulin in the UK. We import every drop of it. You can't transport insulin around ordinarily because it must be temperature controlled. And there are 3.5 million people with diabetes, some of whom rely on insulin, not least the Prime Minister. There is one company." Politicians insisted it would save the authority vital cash and encourage more people to recycle. But furious locals said fly tipping has increased, while families with young children using nappies have particular difficulty from preventing bins overflowing. Jason Lomax Hargreaves, 36, from Wigan, told the Daily Express, "There are families here who are really struggling. There are many homes with at least four people in them, and a lot of rubbish builds up. We have got a fly epidemic. It has been the worst summer I can remember, and fly tipping is increasing." Wigan Council said the scheme's rollout had gone smoothly. But Mr. Lomax Hargreaves said, "I recently went on a littler clear-up and we cleaned up human excrement, sanitary products and needles in an alleyway where children play. We have had problems with rats and mice. Rats have been going into people's houses. On a hot day, the smell can be really bad. It is a health hazard, maggots the lot. This is 21st century Britain. We should be able to have bins collected once a fortnight or once a week and we would still be recycling. If it was once a week, the bins would be fresher. At least it wouldn't be a health hazard." He added, "The rounds sometimes can't be finished because they are too big, even though everything was supposed to be worked out by the managers. It ends up with hundreds of missed bins and loads of rubbish bags that people can't fit into their bins, and we have to pick up all of them. The bags are full of rotting food and maggots." The council wants to increase its recycling rate from 43% to 50% by 2020 or face significant fines. It claims in a consultation exercise residents said they wanted a more frequent blue bin collection for paper and card recycling, but could manage with a less frequent brown bin collection for cans, glass and plastic. The changes are aimed at helping to create savings of £2 million a year. Evidence from other areas in the Brexiteer economist warned the European Union will demand further concessions after seeing the Brexit white paper. Speaking on BBC's Any Questions? Mr. Lyons said Prime Minister Theresa May's Chequers deal was incredibly disappointing. He said, "It lacked vision. It was complex. It was potentially unworkable because of the questions you've asked that the EU may well reject it. They certainly, I think, will demand for further concessions." Mr. Lyons said the white paper, which sets out a 98-page blueprint for the country's future relationship with the EU, was very constraining. Taking a dig at cabinet remainers, he said, "This was a deal made by the Chancellor and the Prime Minister, who see Brexit as making the best of the bad job rather than seizing the great opportunity. I am all in favor of compromises, but this was more like a capitulation." The Economist said the EU should accept the deal but insisted that Mrs. May's proposal for full regulatory alignment with the bloc on goods but not services is unlikely to be accepted. Mr. Lyons warned, "The challenge is that I think the EU may not." One of the positives about the Chequers proposal was the idea of ending the free movement of people. Migration is good, but unlimited migration is not good. You need to have a migration policy, and hence the Brexit debate really did address or bring to people's attention the issue about migration. The key area many people wonder in the next few weeks is whether the European Union will accept what the Prime Minister has proposed, because it goes against the four freedoms and is seen as cherry-picking. But from our own perspective here in the UK, I hope we don't make any further compromises, because already it is far too defensive and it is not forward-looking enough. The key issue is that it constrains future economic domestic policy and certainly constrains our future global ability to set trade deals. The white paper was expected to be published last month, but was delayed after a constant disagreement between cabinet ministers. The EU has so far not responded to the white paper, but one MEP has warned the deal will not be enough. Mr. Brok, who plays a leading role on the European Parliament's Brexit Committee, said Mrs. May's decision to adopt a soft Brexit does not cover one of the EU's four freedoms, nor does it cover paying costs to the EU for single market access. Speaking on BBC Radio 4's Today programme about whether having a single market for goods would solve the Irish border issue, Mr. Brok said, "It might solve it, but I'm not sure whether we accept that. This looks like we have the four freedoms, goods, capital, services, and people, and it takes out one. And it creates conditions, as it would Britain." The US ambassador to the UK, Woody Johnson, warned that the possibility of a bilateral trade deal was totally up in the air after Prime Minister Theresa May's Brexit plan was criticized for creating a soft Brexit. Mr. Johnson, US ambassador to the UK, told BBC Radio 5 Live, "Well, I think the President Donald Trump has stated very clearly that a bilateral with the US is something that he is in favor of. He's also talked about sovereignty, and he's looking at it in our country as well. So yes, I think the bilateral will be an important discussion that he'll have with the Prime Minister, and we will see what happens with Brexit. I don't think anybody really knows yet. We know that there was an important meeting at Chequers, but what it really means at this point, I think it is still up in the air." The resignations of Brexit Secretary David Davis and Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson came days after they approved Mrs. May's soft Brexit plan at Chequers. He added, "I think that there was a briefing that came out, as I understand, it was very short, a couple of pages. This is a lot more complicated than a couple of pages. So, I would say that the bilateral agreement, whether we have one or not, is totally up in the air at this point. From the US standpoint, yes, we would love to do a bilateral and we'll do it. The president said he's like to do it quickly, and all hands on deck, so we'll get it done." Mr. Davis was first to go, announcing his exit on Sunday night, saying he could not be a reluctant conscript to her Brexit approach. In Mr. Johnson's letter, he said, "Brexit should be about opportunity and hope. It should be a chance to do things differently." Conservative MP Grant Shapps accused the shadow foreign secretary of not allowing him to get a word in during a fierce clash live on Sky News. Former Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson resigned less than 24 hours after former Brexit Secretary David Davis and former Brexit Minister Steve Baker left their roles. Mr. Johnson's resignation came just before the Prime Minister defended her Brexit model, which was agreed by Cabinet on Friday at Chequers. During the Sky News clash, the shadow Foreign Secretary outlined Labour's Brexit stance, as she took a dig at resignations on the Conservative front bench. She said, "I want us to be in a customs union and I want us to be as close as we can be to the single market, but we need to have some changes to immigration. That will take negotiation. And whenever we have seen Barnier and whenever we have seen anybody from the European Union, we have said to them, if there was a Labour government, this is what we would be negotiating. And we would be talking to you. We wouldn't be standing on the steps of number 10 Downing Street saying that the rest of Europe is conspiring against us. Let's have a general election. We wouldn't be fighting among ourselves and people disappearing and resigning. How many cabinet ministers have you lost in the last few months? You're losing one every 6 weeks." The Conservative MP, Mr. Shapps, began to reply before he was interrupted by the Labour frontbencher. He said, "That is certainly true that lots of people have walked. But there is no way you can describe Brexit as a simple thing." The Labour shadow foreign secretary interrupted the Conservative MP. She raged, "It is not simple. But you have to focus on it. And you need to focus on not fighting each other and getting on with the job in hand. If you don't want to be the government, walk away and let us be the government." The Conservative MP delivered a speedy response to the fuming Labour politician. He said, "Let me just get a word in here. If you don't want to hear another view, don't let me speak. All I am saying is I went through the Chequers agreement for 2 hours in Downing Street last night. It is incredibly complicated, and the way you make it sound as if all we need to do is sign up for something that isn't quite an EO or something else. It is just not true. It is a massively complex subject. It is possible, and this is the last thing I want to challenge what you said, is rather than people resigning for their personal ambition, actually they are doing it because they believe in these things." The pair began rowing once again, with Miss Thornberry heard saying, "Oh nonsense," before the host was forced to step in. The Prime Minister set out in the House of Commons her Brexit model, which the Cabinet had agreed on last Friday after the Crunch Chequers meeting. She said, "On Friday at Chequers our Cabinet agreed a comprehensive and ambitious proposal that provides a responsible and credible basis for regressing negotiations with the EU towards a new relationship after we leave on the 29th of March next year. It is a proposal that will take back control of our borders." Speaking on BBC Radio 4 Today programme, the former member of the Commons Brexit Committee claimed Theresa May's Chequers agreement showed the Prime Minister does not believe in Brexit and is not prepared to deliver what British people voted for. The Tory MP claimed many Brexiteers in her party believe Theresa May's days as Prime Minister are over. She demanded a new Prime Minister to be voted in, one who passionately believes in Brexit. She said, "When I was at this big Brexit party last night, there was a general feeling in the room that the time has come that we need a Brexiteer Prime Minister, really. Somebody who clearly believes in Brexit and is really prepared to deliver what the people voted for. I think Theresa May's premiership is over. That is obviously my opinion. MPs in our party need to think long and hard in the next few days. I want a Brexiteer Prime Minister. I did 2 years ago when we were going through the leadership, contenders and voters ourselves. And really, I want one who passionately believes in Brexit and will provide true leadership and a positive post-Brexit vision for our country. I really believe that's what our people and our country are crying out for." Ms. Jenkins' comments came as former Brexit Secretary David Davis resigned from his post on Sunday as he disagreed with the Prime Minister's new Brexit stance. Following his resignation, Mr. Davis received the support of many Tory Brexiteers for his decision. Ms. Jenkins, among those who congratulated Mr. Davis, wrote, "Fantastic news. Well done David Davis for having the principle and guts to resign. I take my hat off to you. We need to make sure this is now a game changer for Brexit." Steve Baker, Conservative MP and Brexit Minister, has also quit the government following Mrs. May's proposal. Ms. Jenkins commented on his resignation, stating, "Another courageous and principled MP, Steve Baker, steps down too. Amazing news. Now let's get this party started and make Brexit happen." Former Housing Minister Dominic Raab has now replaced David Davis as the new Brexit Secretary. A statement from Mrs. May's office said, "The Queen has been pleased to approve the appointment of Dominic Raab MP as Secretary of State for exiting the European Union." The Conservative MP was a prominent Leave campaigner during the EU referendum in 2016. He joined the Foreign Office in 2000 and was involved in a range of briefs, including leading a team in The Hague at the British Embassy. In a fiery debate on BBC Question Time, the Tory Minister for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy delivered a punchy comeback to the Shadow Secretary for International Trade over his party's divided position on Brexit. Mr. Gardner claimed despite being a Remainer, he believed delivering Brexit was paramount to avoid becoming a vassal state, as he criticized Theresa May's government approach to the negotiations. The Labour MP said, "I voted Remain, but after the referendum took place I accept that we're leaving, and that means respecting that and not becoming a vassal state." But Miss Perry hit back with this hilarious analogy: "I have great respect for Barry, but Labour's policy on Brexit has had more flip-flops than Brighton Beach on a bank holiday Sunday. I mean, it's just incredible," she added. The Labour Party's position on the Brexit negotiations has received criticism for being as divided as the one Theresa May has been facing in her own party and government. On Wednesday, Labour Deputy Leader Tom Watson claimed his party was still open to the possibility of a second Brexit referendum at the end of the negotiations, despite admitting it would be highly unlikely. He told BBC Radio 4, "It is highly unlikely we would support a people's vote, but we haven't taken that off the table, because there are a rare set of circumstances where Parliament just can't make a decision. And so you keep your options open." Labour leader Jeremy Corbyn said he would like a general election if Theresa May failed to get a deal through Parliament. But on Sunday, the shadow Brexit secretary Keir Starmer said Labour would not rule out another second referendum if Parliament voted down a Brexit deal or the UK failed to reach an agreement with the EU. While he said Labour was not calling for a people's vote on the deal, he said, "The sensible thing is to keep all our options on the table." Speaking on The Andrew Marr Show, he added, "Should the Article 50 deal that the Prime Minister brings back be voted down, or, worse, there's no deal, then that's a very serious situation, and we're going to have to confront it when we get there, and that Parliament must decide what happens next." But Mr. Gardner said, "It is absolutely not our policy to have a second referendum." He said the UK's best interests and the best economic interests are not the same thing, and the referendum result had to be respected. Labour peer Lord Aidaness called for a second referendum following the resignation of David Davis from his Brexit secretary position on Monday. Speaking to Sky News, the Labour peer claimed Parliament should vote down Theresa May's Brexit deal and call for a second referendum to give Britons the chance to remain in the European Union. Lord Aidaness said, "What I think should happen when we see her deal, given that it's going to be a betrayal of our economic national interest, jobs, people's livelihoods." Under proposals announced today, the new speed limit will be introduced on all Transport for London, TfL, roads within the congestion charging zone by 2020. And drivers have taken to social media to criticize the plans, branding them ridiculous and useless. At Rainbow Scanner said on Twitter, "A 20 miles per hour speed limit in London at Sadiq Khan at TfL. Have you considered how much additional pollution this would cause?" Another useless pound sign Nanai State Initiative. At Amalola said, "20 miles per hour in central London by 2020? I predict gridlock. More so, maybe just stop cars altogether and just go back to horse and cart." At LBC pound sign Nanai State. At TrueMagic68 said, "20 miles per hour speed restriction in London, utterly ridiculous policy, which will just make London more gridlocked than ever, not fit for business purpose. We must lament yet another poor Mayor Khan idea in view of the desperate TfL service." The new speed limit is part of the Vision Zero approach by Mr. Khan, TfL and the Metropolitan Police. It aims to eliminate deaths and serious injuries from London's transport network. Mr. Khan said, I don't accept that deaths and serious injuries on London's roads are something we just have to put up with. Every single death or serious injury results in heartache and tragedy for those affected, and their loved ones. Our bold and far-reaching plans being announced today are some of most ambitious in the world, and start from the basis that no death or serious injury on London's roads should be treated as acceptable or inevitable. Every year, more than 2,000 people are killed or seriously injured on London's roads, according to the mayor's office. If a person is hit at 20 miles per hour, they are 5 times less likely to be killed than if they are hit at 30 miles per hour. Edmund King, AA president, said most drivers would be delighted if they could reach speeds of 20 miles per hour in the capital. He said, traffic speeds in central London really haven't changed much since the horse and cart some 100 years ago. Most drivers would be delighted if they could drive at 20 miles per hour across London during the day, but in reality traffic speeds are less than half of that. However, speeds do vary between day and night, so perhaps the 20 miles per hour. Following the Irish-British intergovernmental conference today, Mr. Coveney said, I think there's probably too much talk of the negative consequences of a no-deal Brexit. Instead, we need to focus on what we do as negotiators. Clearly, for Ireland, a no-deal Brexit is bad and for Britain too. I do not think that is a likely scenario, and if it were to happen, it would be a failing of politics on a very significant scale. British and Irish government ministers met in London for a session of their intergovernmental conference, their first meeting in 11 years. Ministers gathered to discuss issues on legacy policies, security cooperation, political instability in Northern Ireland, as well as Ireland's cooperation with the UK post-Brexit. Mr. Coveney said Britain and Ireland are going to remain very close despite the challenges faced between the two governments. He added that there was too much talk of the negative consequences of a no-deal Brexit and that leaving the EU without a deal would be bad for Ireland as well. He said, British ministers and Irish ministers simply won't be meeting in the future in the same way and as frequently as we have done for more than 4 decades now, and so we have instructed senior officials to come up with definitive proposals on how an Irish government and British government in the future can have structured and interactive dialogue at cabinet level in the same way that France and Germany have, for example. This sends a very clear signal that Britain and Ireland are going to remain very close, regardless of the challenges we face. Ahead of a British-Irish intergovernmental conference on Wednesday, the Irish official told BBC's Today programme, I have heard a lot of comment on this issue in recent weeks and, to be honest with you, I think some of it is bravado. The truth is that I don't believe Britain can afford to have no deal on Brexit. I don't believe that Ireland and the EU want that either. He added, the negative implications of a no deal Brexit are very significant for Ireland and for the United Kingdom. We all have an obligation to make sure that that does not happen. Mr. Coveney said Ireland is one of Britain's big allies, and hit out at people who were talking up the possibility of leaving the EU without a deal. He added, a lot of people might not think it listening to me, but, actually, Ireland is one of Britain's big allies in these negotiations. We are a country that is going to stay as part of the European Union, and that is very important to us, but our relationship with Britain is also hugely important. The point I was making this morning when I was asked to comment on the likelihood of a no-deal Brexit was that I think a lot of people are talking up inappropriately the likelihood of a no-deal Brexit. I don't believe it is likely. I don't believe anybody wants it. Challenged about the prospect of a no-deal outcome, Mr. Rob said that while there would be uncertainty in the short term, I think long term actually we would still be able to thrive. He told MPs in the exiting the EU committee, I don't doubt that we would have to look at the uncertainty that we would face in the short term, but I think long term actually we would still be able to thrive. Of course, as with all risks and opportunities, it depends how you mitigate the risks and grasp the opportunities. What I'm not going to do is wallow in pessimism about the state of this country in relation to Brexit, and we are going to go into these negotiations with economic confidence and political ambition. I am going to bring to Mr. Barnier and to the whole enterprise as much energy as I can. What I am not going to do is allow us to cower in the corner, afraid of our own shadow, about the potential that that energy and that ambition and that principle and that pragmatism isn't reciprocated on the other side. I think we will be braced for all the eventualities. Earlier speaking to MPs in the House of Commons, he said, no deal is certainly a real risk, and as the time for the deal approaches, the only responsible thing for us to do is make sure we are ready for all eventualities. Mr. Rob appeared alongside the Prime Minister Europe advisor Ollie Robbins in front of MPs amid increasing Brexiteer concerns about the influence of the senior civil servant. Officials working on the negotiations will be brought together in the Cabinet Office Europe unit headed by Mr. Robbins, who reports direct to the Prime Minister, while Mr. Rob's department for exiting the EU will focus on preparations for life after Brexit. Eurosceptic Tory Craig McKinley suggested there had been a civil service coup d'etat, while fellow Brexiteer Peter Bone suggested Mr. Robbins had been responsible for a secret plan which led to the Chequers' proposals. Mr. Robbins denied both suggestions, telling Mr. McKinley, I honestly don't recognize the picture you are painting, and insisting to Mr. Bone there was never a second secret white paper. Mr. Rob said, we have been very clear about this, there's no tension between us, I think that's clear, that all the advice and all of the meetings will be attended by me, with the Prime Minister, and that all the advice will come to me. He acknowledged that the Chequers plan struck a balance between the UK's ability to diverge from the EU and the need to protect trade and address the Irish border issue. But he said the plan was a roadmap to the sunlit uplands of a final deal which respects the referendum result. Mr. Stanley said he has no doubt Theresa May will cave to the European Union's demands in order to secure a Brexit deal. Speaking on BBC Radio 4's Any Questions? The historian said, my fear is that having opened the door to compromise on goods, they have shown the EU where they are prepared to go next and what they might next compromise on. Mr. Stanley referenced the extraordinary contradiction between Mrs. May saying Britain will not compromise and the EU's Michel Barnier insisting he will not accept separating goods and services. The historian said, that's one of the many other concessions that's going to be made. Why? Because the EU sees its market functioning with four freedoms. Freedom of movement of labor, of money, goods and of services. It doesn't want to just give Britain one deal on goods, it wants to control what Britain does when it comes to money and to services and also to the free movement of people as well. Mr. Stanley warned, what the EU is going to say in the next few weeks is, you've shown us that you're prepared to meet us halfway, you're prepared to work with us when it comes to goods, so why not give us the other stuff too? The problem is, I might trust the government to hold the line on goods, had it not made so many other concessions and compromises up until this point. The government has already said £40,000 billion is on the table as our divorce settlement. The government has already said EU citizens' rights guaranteed. The government has already said defense and intelligence cooperation. There you go. You can have that. So, Knowing what the government has been prepared to concede thus far, I have no doubt that it will cave on the other three things too. But Mr. Stanley dismissed claims that the Brexit dream is dying. Mrs. May's proposal includes plans to create a common rule book, involving a free trade area with the EU on industrial and agricultural goods. The Prime Minister has faced a string of resignations over the past week after the government released its Brexit white paper, including the resignation of former Brexit Secretary David Davis and Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson. The British government's Brexit white paper sets out a 98-page blueprint for the country's future relationship with the EU. European Commission Chief Brexit negotiator Michel Barnier picked apart Mrs. May's white paper on Friday and claimed it failed to offer the Brussels bloc with a concrete basis for negotiations. Following a three-hour meeting with EU ministers in Brussels, Mr. Barnier quickly rejected the white papers and said, on customs, Theresa May said the UK https://www.express.co.uk/news/politics/994289/brexit-news-uk-world-trade-organization-tariffs-no-deal-eu-theresa-may-latest-overment was making preparations for Brexit, but that she was working for a really good deal that's in the interests of people living here in the UK. Mrs. May told Channel 5 News, far from being worried about preparations that we're making, I would say that people should take reassurance and comfort from the fact that the government is saying that we're in a negotiation working for a good deal. I believe we can get a good deal. But actually it's right that we say because we don't know what the outcome is going to be. We think it's going to be a good one. We're working for a good one, but let's prepare for every eventuality. Discussions surrounding a Brexit no deal have increased since the Prime Minister released her Chequers agreement. The white paper led to a series of resignations, including the former Brexit Secretary David Davis and former Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson. Mrs. May added, "This is not just about stockpiling that concept. What it is about making sure that we'll be able to continue to do things that are necessary once we've left the EU, if we leave without a deal. Now I think people should take reassurance from the fact that this is a government that's saying, you know what, we're going to be responsible about this, we're going to be sensible about this. While we're doing that, we're going to work for a really good deal that's in the interests of people living here in the UK." Brexit Secretary Dominic Raab pointed out on Tuesday that there was a real risk of a no-deal Brexit and the UK needs to be ready. He told MPs in the Exiting the EU committee, "I don't doubt that we would have to look at the uncertainty that we would face in the short term, but I think long term actually we would still be able to thrive. Of course, as with all risks and opportunities, it depends how you mitigate the risks and grasp the opportunities. What I'm not going to do is wallow in pessimism about the state of this country in relation to Brexit, and we are going to go into these negotiations with economic confidence and political ambition. I am going to bring to Mr. Barnier and to the whole enterprise as much energy as I can. What I am not going to do is allow us to cower in the corner, afraid of our own shadow, about the potential that that energy and that ambition and that principle and that pragmatism isn't reciprocated on the other side. I think we will be braced for all the eventualities." Earlier speaking to MPs in the House of Commons, he said, "No deal is certainly a real risk, and as the time for the deal approaches, the only risk." Mr. Rowley, 45, believes he may have had the bottle in his home for a couple of days. He said the glass bottle and plastic dispenser were in a cardboard box with plastic molding, and that Miss Sturgis had recognized the brand. She died on July 8 after the pair fell ill on June 30, having been exposed in a vehicle contained in a bottle later found in Mr. Rowley's home in Amesbury, wilts. He said, I remember finding a cosmetic bottle which I had picked up and given to Dawn as a present. I do have a memory of her spraying it on her wrists and rubbing them together. I guess that's how she applied it and became ill. I guess how I got in contact with it is when I put the spray part to the bottle. I ended tipping some on my hands, but I washed it off under the tap. It had an oily substance and I smelled it and it didn't smell of perfume. It felt oily. I washed it off and I didn't think anything of it. It all happened so quick. Within 15 minutes Dawn said she had a headache. She asked me if I had any headache tablets. In that time she said she felt peculiar and needed to lie down in the bath. I went into the bathroom and found her in the bath, fully clothed, in a very ill state. Mr. Rowley said in interviews that he could not recall where he found the perfume box, but believed it looked expensive. He added, unfortunately it turned out to be a bad find. He described Miss Sturgis as a lovely lady and a wonderful woman, and said she had planned to move to Amesbury from John Baker House, her sheltered accommodation in Salisbury, within 2 weeks. Mr. Rowley also said he still feels to blame for what happened to her but criticized the irresponsible people who left the poison for anybody to pick up. He said, I'm very angry at the whole incident. The revelations come as police announce the cordon at Miss Sturgis's home would be lifted after investigators found no contamination risk at the building. Mr. Rowley and Miss Sturgis were victims of the second nerve agent incident in 4 months after the poisoning of former Russian Spicer Gaisk. The Airbus chief said they are in the process of building additional safety stocks to prepare for Britain crashing out of the European Union with a no-deal Brexit. Last month the aerospace giant warned Theresa May it would consider relocating outside of the UK unless the British government could provide certainty. Tom Williams told Channel 4 News, we're in the process of building additional safety stocks on the assumption that there may be some disruption. While we are optimistic that the Prime Minister and the government will find a good solution, we have to protect ourselves against the worst-case scenario. Mr. Williams warned a staggering 14,000 UK jobs could be at risk in the event the Prime Minister came out of the negotiations with Brussels with no deal. Airbus is the first major manufacturer to commit to pulling investment from Britain after the country leaves the bloc. The company, which creates £1.7 billion in tax revenues every year, is looking to move production of aircraft wings to the US, China or another European country. The Airbus boss added, the worst-case scenario is that we go off the cliff edge at the end of March. Should there be no extension to the EU transition period, the company threatened to stop partnering with any new UK suppliers. Airbus directly employs 14,000 people in the UK, and their business supports a further 110,000 around the country. They have trained 4,000 apprentices in the last decade, and have main production sites in Plymouth, North Wales, Stevenage and Bristol. Only 235 days remain before Britain officially leaves the bloc on March 29, 2019. With Mrs. May's newly published Brexit white paper under constant threat before it even reaches the negotiating table with Brussels. Earlier on Tuesday evening, she managed to stave off defeat at the hands of Tory rebels supported by MPs from opposition. The Prime Minister is set to meet leading figures from the agricultural industry at the Royal Welsh Show, and she is expected to tell them the EU's common agricultural policy, which provides subsidies, will be replaced after Brexit with a new scheme of public money for public goods. She will say, leaving the EU presents us with a unique opportunity to transform our food, farming and environmental policies so we can have a healthy and prosperous agricultural industry that is fit for the future, and helps us to leave the environment in a better place than we found it. I want to make the most of the freedoms provided by Brexit to design a new scheme that is less bureaucratic and does away with the overly prescriptive information farmers currently have to provide to apply for grants. The Prime Minister's speech will come amid growing concerns from the Welsh First Minister that a no-deal scenario could provide a funding crisis. Carwyn Jones claimed farming could be destroyed in Wales if their farmers do not get the funds they were promised. He said, "If we don't get the money that we were promised from the UK government, farming is going to get destroyed in Wales, because the promise was that Wales would not lose out a single penny in funding. Is that promise going to be kept on? If it is going to be kept on, fine, we can make sure that whilst farmers are not disadvantaged, those who pushed Brexit can stand up and keep their promises." Prime Minister Theresa May has vowed to pull the UK out of the European Union's controversial Common Agricultural Policy post-Brexit. The EU has been criticised for botched agricultural subsidies on a number of occasions. Most famously, a guaranteed price for milk in the 1980s leading to butter mountains and an oversupply of milk. On Monday, at the Royal Welsh Show, farmers hailed the opportunity the UK will have once Britain has cut ties from the European Union and the controversial Common Agricultural Policy. When asked whether Brexit was an opportunity, a farmer told Channel 4, "Yes, as a young farmer it is an opportunity. I was looking at it as a young farmer's perspective. The whole subsidies system in this country." Jacob Rees-Mogg voiced concerns Theresa May's Brexit negotiating strategy indicates the Prime Minister remains unconvinced about leaving the European Union. In a tense interview on The Andrew Marr Show, Mrs. May suggested Brexiteers like Mr. Mogg voted with their hearts rather than with their heads. The North Somerset MP rejected the Prime Minister's claims during a BBC Sunday Politics appearance. The Prime Minister said people voted with their hearts and she was doing something with her head. "In my view, and in the view of most Brexiteers, head and heart come together. Head and heart come together. Brexit is enormously positive. A huge opportunity for the country. I'm afraid the Prime Minister doesn't see that, and it's why I think she is a Remainer who has remained a Remainer." Mr. Rees-Mogg, who heads the Eurosceptic European Research Group, ERG, also expressed his criticism of the government's strategy so far, saying that negotiations had conceded to EU demands from the start. He added, "It seems to me a hopeless way to negotiate, that you accept what the other side says in the early stages of the negotiations as holy writ. In a negotiation, two sides say what they want. You don't just as one side say the EU said this, we must follow it." The government unfortunately believes that Brexit is not a good thing in itself. It seems to think it has to be tempered with non-Brexit. In an article published on the Sunday Express, Mr. Rees-Mogg openly claimed she had abandoned her Brexit means Brexit mantra and instead wasted taxpayers' money pretending she would deliver Brexit to the British voters. He wrote, "The Chequers U-turn, the failure of the Mansion House test and abandonment of Brexit means Brexit has broken trust. It would have been more straightforward to admit that no real Brexit was the intention all along rather than trying to gull Brexiteers. Perhaps we ought to have realized earlier on that a Remainer would stick with Remain." Government whips were last week said to be begging colleagues to withdraw letters to prevent the total reaching 48, the number that would trigger the crunch vote. Mr. Rees-Mogg said he has no intention of submitting a letter, but he and other Brexiteers have said they cannot vote for the white paper as it stands. He has tabled four amendments to the government's trade legislation, one of which calls for a commitment to be enshrined in law that there will be no customs border in the Irish Sea. There was further trouble for the Prime Minister last night as Labour opened up its biggest poll lead. Gareth Southgate's style has taken over the nation as England's impressive World Cup performance leads to football fans across the country wanting to imitate the 47-year-old's classic look. BBC host Andrew Marr hopped on the trend and hilariously opened his Sunday political show by thanking the England boss for giving the country a calm and decisive leader. Opening his BBC show, Mr. Marr said, "Good morning and a big confrontation with Brussels looms. Those who have waited are now blessed with a calm, decisive leader they can believe in. So, thank you, Gareth Southgate." The trend, dubbed as the Gareth Effect, has caused waistcoat sales to soar in the past week. Last week, Marks & Spencer revealed that sales of waistcoats soared by a huge 35% since the World Cup kicked off. Southgate's men dominated its quarter-final World Cup game against Sweden on Saturday, securing them a position in the semi-finals of the tournament for the first time in 28 years. The young and talented team have become the first England side to qualify for a World Cup semi-final since Italia 90, when they lost on penalties to West Germany in a heartbreaking shootout. The win has set up a semi-final against Croatia, while France and Belgium face off in the other last four match. Following the win on Saturday, Prime Minister Theresa May said, "Huge congratulations to Gareth Southgate and his team. Another excellent win to make the whole country proud." While Labour leader Jeremy Corbyn stepped up his campaign for a bank, the former Tory MP ripped into claims Theresa May will force Britain into a Brexit deal in which it remains in full regulatory alignment with the EU on goods but not services. Mr. Portillo insisted the vote of 17.4 Brits to leave the European Union must be respected. He told BBC's This Week, "I think you'd be surprised how broadly this will be felt in the country. They voted individually, the country reached a decision, and then the country was cheated out of the decision that it had made. What is the point in voting if you are told that you are participating in the most important vote in a generation or two and then something else is delivered?" Mr. Portillo warned that a soft Brexit could lead Britain into a decade of instability, with both Remainers and Brexiteers displeased. He said, "It is difficult to see what we get out of this, and worse than that, the situation, of course, would be so absurd that it couldn't possibly be Britain's final resting place. The Remainers would say you can't have a situation where decisions are being taken in our absence, we have to rectify that by going back in. And the Leavers would say, you cannot have a situation where we are a vassal state, we have to revisit this and get out. So what people usher in is another decade of instability." Mrs. May persuaded her cabinet to back her plans for a soft Brexit last night. The Prime Minister declared the 12-point blueprint will speed up the UK's exit from the Tory MP Kwasi Kwarteng blasted patronising activists calling for a second referendum on Brexit to change the results of the 2016 EU referendum. The Brexiteer politician argued a second vote on the withdrawal terms agreed with the European Union would lead to endless referendums until Remain won. Discussing demands for a fresh vote on Brexit on Sky News, Mr. Kwarteng said, "I think if you go down the second referendum route, you're in the kind of never-ending world where you'll just be having endless referendums. The whole idea of a second referendum I find slightly patronizing, because the implication is that somehow the voters got it wrong and they are like school children and we have to say, well, read your homework and get the right answer." Mr. Kwarteng added, "That's very patronizing and I don't think it's very helpful to democracy." A new Sky Data survey published on Monday showed that 78% of Britons think the government should hold a new referendum before Brexit becomes official. The poll also suggested the public is dissatisfied with Theresa May and her handling of the withdrawal, with 74% of the poll giving the Prime Minister a thumb down. Mrs. May, however, dismissed calls for a second referendum in the middle of her 2 weeks walking holiday in Italy and Switzerland, saying there would be no second referendum in any circumstances. But Remainer peer Peter Mandelson suggested that pledging to hold a people's vote on the terms of exit could strengthen Mrs. May's weakened position. Lord Mandelson said, "The people now want to make an informed judgment and choice between what is on offer and the benefits we already had in the European Union. If she promises a people's vote, it will strengthen her hand against the Brexitremists in her own party. She has got to turn round to them and say what I negotiate has to pass muster." Michael Portillo ripped into Theresa May's Brexit plan, labelling it a betrayal of Brexiteers in her party. Mr. Portillo said, "Anna Salbrey is pushing this point that the Brexiteers are in charge. What Mrs. May has brought from the Chequers agreement is something which most Conservative Remainers can vote for and no Conservative Brexiteers can vote for. So, in the long run, in all of the things that matter, the Remainers have won and the Brexiteers have lost." Now, on the detail last week, it's true they had to whip the Remainers and treat them pretty harshly. But that's only because the Brexiteers have already lost and the Remainers have already won. Mr. Portillo added that the Chequers agreement is viewed by many Conservative Party members as a betrayal. He said, "It's very hard to see how that's going to get through. The Brexiteers now believe she is a traitor. This has been a betrayal, and it's a betrayal that has resulted from treachery. That's also the view of a large number of Conservative voters." The Chequers agreement thrashed out between the Prime Minister and her cabinet earlier this month sparked fury among Brexit-supporting MPs because it would lock the UK into a single standards model and a common rulebook for goods, effectively forcing British manufacturers to abide by EU regulations after the UK leaves the bloc. Brexit Secretary David Davis and Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson later resigned in protest over the proposals. Mrs. May is under growing pressure from Brexit-supporting Tory MPs, with rumours swirling that 1922 committee chair Sir Graham Brady has almost received the 48 letters of no confidence required to trigger a confidence vote of the parliamentary party. Conservative MP Andrew Breedon has revealed that he expects rebels to reach the number over the summer. He told the BBC's Daily Politics. Ronnie Campbell, the Labour MP for Blyth Valley, has claimed Michelle Barnier's sole role is to be awkward in negotiations. The Brexit supporter also warned the European Union would not give the UK a deal during negotiations. Speaking exclusively to express.co.uk, Mr. Campbell discussed the possibility of a second Brexit referendum, before he ripped into the Brussels bloc. He said, "I don't think people would relish another referendum, quite honestly. The only people who want another referendum are the fanatics who want to stay in Europe. People I meet in the streets say, 'Oh, we don't need more referendums, we've had one, just get what deal they can get.' I keep saying you're not going to get a deal. Them lot, the EU, are not going to give you a deal. There's no way you're going to get a deal. You think Michel Barnier has been put in there to give you a deal? He is not there to give you a deal, he's there to make it as awkward as possible." Speaking in May, Mr. Campbell added that it was wishful thinking to think the European Union would offer the UK a suitable agreement. He said, "I will be right at the end of the day, there will be no deal for this country coming from the European Union." It comes following a turbulent week for the Prime Minister, who was forced to reshuffle her cabinet after former Brexit Secretary David Davis and former Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson resigned from their roles. The Brexit supporters claimed they could not back the Prime Minister's model for leaving the European Union, which was agreed by the cabinet at Chequers last Friday. Former Health Secretary Jeremy Hunt was reassigned to the role of Foreign Secretary and Dominic Raab became the Brexit Secretary. The Prime Minister set out her Brexit model in the House of Commons on Monday. She said, "On Friday at Chequers, our cabinet agreed a comprehensive and ambitious proposal that provides a responsible and credible basis for regressing negotiations with the EU towards a new relationship after we leave on the 29th of March next year. It is a proposal that will take back control of our borders, our money and our laws. But do so in a way that protects jobs, allows us to strike new trade deals through an independent trade policy, and keeps people safe and our union together." Addressing policymakers at the Council on Foreign Relations, Mr. Barnier said, "Once again, I regret profoundly the vote of the UK. We respect it and we will implement it. But, it's day after day clearer, not only on the UK side, but also for the European side in each of our countries, what it means to be in the EU and what it means to be out of the EU. I can tell you that it is crystal clear at the end of this negotiation, that the best situation, with the best relationship with the EU, will remain to be a member of the EU." Eamon Holmes rubbished fear-mongering claims suggesting the UK would be forced to stockpile food and other products in the event of a no-deal Brexit. Brexit Secretary Dominic Raab announced the government will make sure Britain has adequate food stock should the country leave the European Union without a new arrangement. Discussing the claims with Remain activist Femi Aluwal, the talk radio host said, "Could I just say to you they need to sell that to us? Turn down that market, one third of their produce is coming to the UK. Do you know what diarrhea looks like? Because I would say, if I was a farmer in the rest of Europe, I would be pooing myself as to this market drying up. Do you actually believe they would find an alternative market straight away?" Mr. Holmes added, "What happened? How did we survive before the common market came about? We didn't starve to death." The anti-Brexit activist hit back saying the interpretation of trading data was skewed, arguing that failing to reach an agreement with Brussels on future commercial arrangements would delay British supply chains and force the government to adopt new tariffs and border checks. Mr. Aluwal said, "We always put it in terms of our perspective. From their perspective, one third of the food we need is not one third of their economy. Let's be really clear about this. They will continue to try to sell it. The thing is, right now, at the port in Dover, food and all the product we get just in time, because that's how we operate, they flow through freely. There is no need for checks, we are in a customs union. What happens if we are out of the customs union? What happens if there's suddenly different standards on either side of the border? That means you actually have to start checking lorries." Mr. Aluwal also said pulling Britain out of the EU bloc without a new deal could give EU competitors an advantage when it came to trade. He continued, "Before the common market, our competitors across Europe did not have the advantages of the common market. The argument that we were fine before Brexiteer Kate Holyoake attacked supporters of a second referendum, during an interview on Sky News, for trying to reverse Brexit despite the fact that ordinary decent people across the country have accepted we are leaving the European Union." Ms. Holyoake, the MP for Vauxhall, told Sky's Adam Bolton, "I think there has already been compromise on the Leave side, now maybe we need a little bit more compromise on the Remain side. For example, those people who are still pushing for the ridiculous idea of a second referendum." She added, "The people who are now pushing a second referendum are really people who know that they have lost the argument on us leaving, and the vast majority of people, even those who voted Remain, ordinary decent people across the country have accepted we are leaving. It is only a small group of people both within all the political parties, but also within the establishment, within the media, particularly in London, they would really still like to reverse this decision. If they can't do it by stealth, which they are trying to do, they will want to have a second referendum. It is only the people who want to wreck it that keep pushing this idea. The people's vote, which campaigns for a second vote on the Brexit deal, is supported by prominent Remainers such as former Labour Senior Campaigns Director Alistair Campbell and Labour MP Shagamina. Theresa May indicated the cabinet had agreed upon a collective position on its Brexit stance at the Chequers meeting on Friday and would seek a model similar to the single market for goods and the facilitated customs arrangement. The Prime Minister commented on the resolution stating, "Today in detailed discussions the cabinet has agreed our collective position for the future of our negotiations with the EU. Our proposal will create a UK/EU free trade area which establishes a common rulebook for industrial goods and agricultural products. This maintains high standards in these areas, but we will also ensure that no new changes in the future take place without the approval of our Parliament. As a result, we avoid friction in terms of trade, which protects jobs and livelihoods, as well as meeting our commitments in Northern Ireland." The resignations of Brexit Secretary David Davis and Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson came days after they approved Mrs. May's soft Brexit plan at Chequers. In Mr. Davis's official resignation letter, he said, "The national interest requires a Secretary of State in my department." Mr. Gove claimed the government's Brexit plan honours the Leave vote but faced a brutal response by the BBC host, who pointed out that the proposal still means Britain will be subject to European courts. Following crunch talks in Chequers on Friday, the Prime Minister gained unanimous backing by her cabinet for her blueprint for Britain's future relationship with the bloc. As a result of the meeting, it was agreed that the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice (EC) will end, but the UK will still be influenced by its decisions in areas where common rules are implemented. After the plan was revealed, Environment Secretary promised that Britain will be outside the direct jurisdiction of the EC, but admitted that the European courts will still remain influential in Britain after Brexit. BBC host Andrew Marr grilled the prominent Brexiteer and said, "Can you sit there and say that the European Court will have no influence on British public life going forward?" In response, Mr. Gove said, "No, but it will end. There's a critical thing here. If Britain had absolutely no tie, no trade agreement, no dealings with Europe, the European Court of Justice would still determine the rules in our large neighbour, and that would have a bearing on the decisions that we would take about how we got our goods into their market. The critical difference is that in the European Union the European Court of Justice is in effect the UK's Supreme Court. It has direct effect, and that jurisdiction will end." He added, "The particular area here is that the ex-judgments and European law will be taken into account by our courts with specific reference to trade arrangements." But Marr hit back and said, "So, they will still be influential? So, people saying no more European courts in this country, that's not true. They will still be here. They will still be influential." Mr. Gove insisted European courts will not be influential, but the BBC host hit back and asked whether the government will do what they say anyway. The Environment Secretary claimed the BBC host was not representing the position fairly, insisting the European Court of Justice's writ will end after Brexit. He added, "It is only with respect to a limited number of areas where our courts may, should they choose to, take account of EU law and the interpretation of the application of things that we have already agreed." But Marr continued to grill the Environment Secretary and said, "I think this is fake sovereignty." In response, Mr. Gove blasted, "I think that you're wrong. I think that is a fake question. He added, what you are doing is manufacturing a sense of fake or even mock outrage. The joint statement signed by the Prime Minister and her cabinet ministers put forward a plan for an economic and security partnership with the European Union. Theresa May declared the 12-point blueprint will speed up the UK's exit from the EU. She said, now we must all move at pace to negotiate our proposal with the EU to deliver the prosperous and secure future all our people deserve. But the proposal has sparked outrage from Brexiteer MPs with Tory backbencher Andrea Jenkins, who said she would be prepared to vote against the government even if it falls. She said, I, personally, am prepared to vote against it, and if the detail is as bad as we are hearing, then I am also prepared to put a letter into the 22. The Tory MP said she would want a new party leader. The former UKIP leader hit out at the nationwide protests against Mr. Trump's visit to the UK and said the whole thing is ridiculous. Speaking on Fox News, Mr. Farage said, what is going on here is the liberal left press demonized Trump every single day, and unfortunately quite a few people believe that. I have to say, protest is fine in a democracy, but to be flying this blimp, this kite of Donald Trump outside Parliament. How Sadiq Khan can allow that, I will never know. Whatever anybody thinks of President Trump, America is our closest and most important ally in the world. Frankly, I'm ashamed of that today. The Capitol was swarmed with anti-Trump protesters, with many fuming Britons bringing their young children along to the demonstrations that hit major landmarks, while the controversial baby Trump blimp flew over the city. As part of the protests, a blimp flew above Parliament Square as protesters took to the streets of London. The balloon depicts the US president as an angry baby wearing a nappy and holding a mobile phone. As it ascended, the balloon leaned forward and managed to rise a mere 20 feet above the ground. It appeared unstable as it wobbled over the crowd that had come out to see it. The blimp was mocked by Twitter users, with Tory MP Steve Baker tweeting, "Is that it?" While @Leninsf tweeted, "That Trump baby blimp isn't even big, haha, yes, got scammed." Prior to his visit, Mr. Trump hit out at Mr. Khan and said he has done a terrible job as London mayor. In an explosive interview inside the US embassy in Brussels, the US president said the London mayor has done a very bad job on terrorism. He told The Sun, "I think allowing millions and millions of people to come into Europe is very, very sad. I look at cities in Europe, and I can be specific if you'd like. You have a mayor who has done a terrible job in London. He has done a terrible job." Trump also said Sadiq Khan has shown the US a lack of respect after London City Hall, run by the London mayor, granted permission for a 6-meter inflatable of the US president, complete with nappy and man boobs, to fly over the Capitol during his visit. He said, "I think he has not been hospitable to a government that is very important. Now he might not like the current president, but I represent the United States. I also represent a lot of people in Europe, because a lot of people from Europe are in the United States." Mr. Khan had a message for the US president. He said, "Well, my message to President Trump is we Londoners love your country." He added, "We love Americans. There are Americans here who contribute to our city economically, socially and culturally." London Mayor Sadiq Khan has also come under attack for approving the protest, which will see a blimp depicting Mr. Trump as an angry, orange baby rise above Parliament Square Gardens for 2 hours on Friday morning. The decision has been slammed by as disrespectful by Tory MPs, who warn it could be potentially damaging to the British economy. Tory MP Philip Davies said, "Mr. Khan seems to be more interested in sidling up to Labour groups like Momentum than delivering on the best for the British economy." A Downing Street spokeswoman said, We are a free and open democracy, and we believe in the right to peaceful protest. But I would also say that I think the majority of British people understand the importance of the UK-US alliance. Regarding the Trump baby balloon, the spokeswoman said it was up to the Greater London Assembly to explain why it had approved it. She said, "From our perspective, the presidential visit is an important moment to recognize our close and special relationship and to have open and frank discussions on the key issues." Trump supporters in the US are appalled by the decision to allow the protest to go ahead. Former New York Mayor Rudy Giuliani fumed, "Sadiq Khan should be ashamed of himself. Maybe he should just do his job instead of attacking a world leader. I would not like to go to a country where someone with the authority of a mayor was rallying people against them. It's highly inappropriate." US actor James Woods tweeted, "Like all stunts that humiliate others, this will backfire. Leave it as a symbol of London's failure to be civil. We Americans have bigger issues to fix and goals to achieve." Theresa May said she was looking forward to her meeting with Mr. Trump. She said, "We will be talking positively about how we can continue to work together in our special relationship for the good of people living in the UK and the United States and, actually, for the wider good." Mr. Khan clashed with Piers Morgan on Good Morning Britain when he said he supported the GLA decision taken and insisted it was not for him to be a censor. He said, "My views are irrelevant. The issue is, though, they have freedom to protest, freedom to assemble, and should they be allowed to do so? If it's peaceful and it's safe, they should, Piers. I can't be the censor. It's not for me to decide what's in good taste or bad taste." Mr. Trump's schedule will largely keep him out of central London, and it seems unlikely that the US president will come close enough to Westminster to see the blimp. He will arrive in the UK on board Air Force One on Thursday afternoon, straight from the NATO summit in Brussels, and will carry out a series of engagements on Friday before heading to Scotland for the weekend. Mr. Khan and the American leader have engaged in a long-running war of words over issues like crime and terrorism. Mr. Morgan said it was utterly ironic and weird that there could be bigger protests around Mr. Trump's visit than during trips to the UK by the leaders of countries with questionable human rights records, including Saudi Arabia and Turkey. But Mr. Khan said it was important that the UK could be candid with the US as a close ally, saying that's how special relations. From the pictures that have been released so far, it can be seen that the fortification has been built with all the required defensive measures, which include crenellated outer walls with towers and battlements, and an inner bailey protecting the Great Tower. It also features a gatehouse with portcullis and drawbridge, and a ditch and bank around the outside aimed at stopping enemies approaching the walls directly. Roy Porter, English Heritage Senior Properties Curator and creator of the castle, said, "A castle is surely one of the most awe-inspiring sights, but if you look closely, all is not what it seems. These amazing structures are a brilliant mix of ages and types, reflecting changing threats and fashions over centuries. Part of the fun of visiting them is using a Sherlock-like eye to tease out their secrets. By studying hundreds of years of trial and error by the real castle builders, our ultimate sum castle contains everything you'd like to see, with each element showing off castle building perfection from a different era. The model took 5 days to make, and it has been created to celebrate the start of a weekend dedicated to sum castle building across all English heritage castles in England." Mr. Porter added, "I hope people will be inspired to build their very own ultimate sum castle this summer, and support English Heritage to care for all our real castles so that they can continue to inspire us all for centuries to come." The organization also launched the campaign #LoveCastles on social media to call on members of the public to send pictures of their own sand sculptures. Jamie Wardley, Sand in Your Eye sand sculptor, commented on his creation saying, "At Sand in Your Eye we're used to creating great, big sand sculptures all over the world, but this was definitely a once-in-a-lifetime experience. To be able to build and sculpt the most perfect castle, not only from a visual point of view but also historically, using Roy's research into hundreds of years' worth of castle-building history, was a real first for us. The ultimate castle at Dover will be on display until mid-August. At the SUM Castle Building Workshops this weekend, the English Heritage will reveal its top tips for building a castle on the beach. Some of these tips include using wet sand, using hands to compact and sculpt and a ruler to shape the sand. Then patting it with other hand and then sliding the hand from under the sump, leaving a drawbridge over the dip." Yvette Cooper voiced concerns about a lack of debate on the future immigration system Britain will adopt for EU citizens after Brexit and demanded a public consultation on the matter. BBC Radio 4's Today programme presenter Matthew Price shot her down, reminding her of the status of European Union nationals was a key part of talks with Brussels and could not be debated with the public. Mr. Price said, "It would have been quite difficult to have done that in public. If the Brexit minister was sitting here now, he would say, well, that would have been impossible. We can't do it openly in public because it is part of the negotiations." Ms. Cooper lamented the government's failure to deliver on the immigration white paper former Home Secretary Amber Rudd had announced would be published in autumn 2017. She said, "We have no clarity at all. We were promised a white paper on immigration about 12 months ago. We've been promised it repeatedly since. The timing has just changed. It was a key issue during the referendum debate. It was an issue that divided the country, and what we should have had, over the last 2 years, is a serious, thoughtful debate about how we overcome those immigration divides, about how we can try to build consensus, what the way forward should be. Clearly, it will be an extremely important issue in the negotiations. Parliament will be having talks about immigration. It's just there has been no consultation with the public." Theresa May is set to release the Brexit white paper today to lay out her intentions for a future trade deal with Brussels. The terms of the new blueprint were agreed during a tense Chequers meeting last Friday and led to the resignation of Brexit Secretary David Davis and Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson. Mrs. May committed to Britain being able to make decisions on immigration. The Prime Minister said, "It will mean a genuine end to freedom of movement. No longer will people be allowed to arrive here from across Europe on the off chance that they might find a job. It will be the UK, not Brussels, that decides." Speaking on Sky News, the Conservative MP claimed Theresa May has only two options left to conclude her Brexit negotiations with Brussels. Mr. Redwood argued one last resource before leaving the EU without a deal would be to table a comprehensive free trade agreement for the EU to accept. The Tory Brexiteer added leaving without an agreement would give the UK an incredible economic boost as Britain will be able to spend £39 billion on national priorities such as public services. He said, "Quite a lot of people are critical of the government because it's taking a long time and many people think the government has offered too much to the European Union and the EU has offered us nothing in return. I find the mood of the British public is that they still want Brexit, they'd like to get on with it. Their message to the government is, let's just get on with this, speed it up. And if we just leave next March 2019 as we quite entitled to do, we don't owe them a penny and we can get on with spending that £39 billion which the government did offer the EU to try and tempt them with a very good deal. And we can spend that on our priorities and that would be a big boost to our economy and that will cheer everybody up. So that's probably the best course of action now. Confronted with a new poll showing 78% of Britons now do not believe the government has done a good job in the negotiations so far, he replied, "That's because the Chequers offer was both too generous and the EU immediately slapped it down as many of us feared it would. So my advice to Prime Minister now, because I want her to succeed and I want to help lift her ratings, is that there are just two options from here. One is the one I've outlined, let's just leave next March and have all that money at our own disposal on things like seasonal workers. We will make the decision, so if we as a country want to welcome in more seasonal workers, we'll be quite in our right to do so. Or the other option is to table now a fully comprehensive free trade agreement, something I asked them to do over 2 years ago, and say to the EU, do you want a tariff-free trade agreement or don't you? And that would be an exceedingly generous offer to the EU, but they may or may not take it." Mr. Redwood added, "Trading under TO rules is not going to make my constituents poorer. It's going to make them a lot richer. If we just leave next March, we can get on with spending the £39 billion that we'd otherwise be sending to the EU." The SNP's Westminster leader issued a stern warning to force the British government into reconsidering its decision to leave the single market and the customs union as part of its Brexit strategy. Nicola Sturgeon's party has long lamented that leaving the European Union would have dire effects on the Scottish economy and demanded Prime Minister Theresa May reconsider her position. During an appearance on BBC show Any Questions? Mr. Blackford said, "Something very important happened in Parliament just last week, because we had a debate on the claim of right and the issue of where sovereignty rests, and Parliament accepted that, unlike in the English system where sovereignty rests with Parliament, in Scotland sovereignty rests with the people. Westminster better realise that there is a mandate that the Scottish Parliament has, and if the Scottish people chose to have that vote on their future at the right time, we'll be having it." Mr. Blackford also said the SNP would work with the British government over the last few months of the Brexit negotiations with Brussels to safeguard the interests of Scotland. He insisted membership of the single market and the customs union were not part of the 2016 EU referendum and suggested a majority of MPs was of the same mind with the SNP. The Scottish politician continued, "What I would say is, we will take our responsibilities over the coming months to do all we can to work across party and to encourage other members of Parliament to get to a position where we stay in the single market and the customs union. That's the first priority. I firmly believe that there is a majority in the House of Commons for that, and I would simply make the point that membership of the single market and the customs union was not on the ballot paper. Scotland is dragged out of the single market and the customs union against its will. Then we have to remember that the SNP won a mandate to put the independence question to the peoples of Scotland if there's a material change of circumstances." First Minister Sturgeon and May argued that a new Scottish independence referendum was a much bigger case than Brexit. She also claimed that some aspects of the Brexit debate had added fuel and strengthened her plans to see Scotland break away from the UK. The SNP threat comes as Mrs. May fights off pressure from Brexit hardliners in her party, voicing concerns over the government's latest Brexit blueprint. Her proposal would see Britain maintain its close trading links with Brussels through a free trade area administered by a common rulebook. But Brexiteers fear the common rulebook would leave the country under EU rule. Justine Greening criticised the Prime Minister's Chequers Brexit agreement and has called for another Brexit vote. Talk radio host Julia Hartley Brewer pointed out to the Tory MP that the UK had already had a vote on cutting ties with the Brussels Club. Ms. Greening said, "The only way that we can, therefore, find a clear direction forward on Brexit is to go back to the British people and put the decision back in their hands. The host then demanded to know what would be on the ballot paper if Ms. Greening got her wish with another vote. The Conservative MP said, "I am saying it needs to offer the three choices that in practice we have. Either a soft Brexit, which is what the Prime Minister is offering, I think in practice. That is the worst of all worlds. I think if you are a Remain voter that thinks, hang on, if we are having all the rules we might as well be sat around the table, or whether you are one of the many Leave voters who have certainly been in touch with me saying, this isn't what we voted for, it certainly isn't a clean break from the European Union. I think that nevertheless needs to be on the ballot paper. I think a clean break does need to be on the ballot paper too. A no-deal scenario, in other words. And I think, of course, I think staying in the EU is a third route forward." The talk radio host Ms. Hartley Brewer then turned on the Tory MP, demanding to know why remaining in the EU would even be an option. The presenter pointed out the UK had already had a vote and had decided to leave the bloc. She said, "Why do you feel that the Remain option should be on there? A soft Brexit slash a no-deal Brexit is one thing that possibly could be considered, but we have already voted for Leave, why would we need to have Remain back on that ballot paper?" The Conservative MP claimed in practice, it's one of the three principal options, which enraged the host even more. Ms. Hartley Brewer said, "It's not. We have already voted to leave. And we have triggered Article 50. You talk about an impasse in Parliament. There was a manifesto commitment from David Cameron there would be a referendum, he won that election. Then MPs voted for there to be an EU referendum. Then MPs voted to trigger Article 50. MPs have voted for the EU withdrawal bill. Why do you think Remain is still on the menu?" The Tory MP said Leave voters would ideally have a clean break, but if that was not possible, they would prefer to have an influence around the table. Ms. Hartley Brewer finished by claiming she had not met a single Leave voter with that opinion. Speaking on Monday morning on the Today program, Ms. Greening said, "It shouldn't just be my voice that gets listened to. I represent the largely Remain." Ollie Robbins, the Prime Minister's advisor, faced questions from the exiting the EU Committee on Brexit. He said, "As I tried to explain earlier, the closest colleagues I have had in this job have been colleagues in the Department for exiting the EU, and they were throughout this process." Mr. Rees-Mogg said, "The former Secretary of State has said he didn't know, so are you saying that he is misinforming us?" Mr. Robbins responded, "No, I am not saying that. I am telling you what I can about the process, which is it was a closed, collaborative one." But Mr. Rees-Mogg said it was worrying that the plans presented to the cabinet at Chequers appeared to have been drawn up by the Europe unit without the knowledge of David Davis, whose department was working on its own white paper at the time. The Tory MP said, "Thank you very much, I think that is extremely helpful, but it is worrying that the authority that changed today hadn't happened then. Things were going on that the department that were meant to be in charge of it was unaware of. I attribute no blame to you at all because you're answerable to the Prime Minister." Mr. Robbins said that both papers drew on work which had taken place over many months, but that Mrs. May had asked for a draft of the paper to be presented at Chequers about a fortnight before the cabinet away day. He added, "There wasn't some sudden twist in the road where one white paper was done away with and a new white paper written." Theresa May informed Parliament she is taking personal control of EU withdrawal negotiations, with new Brexit Secretary Dominic Raab deputising for her in talks. Civil servants working on the negotiations will be brought together in the Cabinet Office Europe unit headed by Ollie Robbins, who reports direct to the Prime Minister, while Mr. Raab's department for exiting the EU will focus on preparations for life after Brexit. Labour said Mr. Raab had been sidelined after just 15 days in the job, While the Leave Means Leave campaign said Mr. Robbins had seized control of the process, guaranteeing that Brexit would be a name only. But Mr. Robb dismissed suggestions that his department had been downgraded as a caricature, playing the development down as shifting of the Whitehall deck chairs. He revealed that he agreed the changes on the day he was offered the job following David Davis's resignation earlier this month. Mr. Robb told the House of Commons exiting the EU committee, "The Prime Minister suggested it to me. On taking up the appointment, we had a very sensible conversation about the crossroads of the negotiations we are in, some of the tensions that were widely reported." Mr. Robb said he and the PM discussed what we do to make sure we have the optimum arrangements, one team, one negotiation, clear chain of command, that would put us in the very best professional position to get the best deal. The new minister let slip details of the new arrangements in the House of Commons last week, when he was asked if he would be calling the shots in his new job. He replied then, "No, it is the Prime Minister and the Cabinet. I will be deputizing for the Prime Minister in the negotiations." Now Mrs. May has spelled out exactly how the change will work in a written statement to MPs. She said, "I will lead the negotiations with the European Union, with the Secretary of State for exiting the European Union deputizing on my behalf. Both of us will be supported by the Cabinet Office Europe Unit, and with this in mind, the Europe Unit will have overall responsibility for the preparation and conduct of the negotiations, drawing upon support from DGSU and other departments as required. A number of staff will transfer from DGSU to the Cabinet Office to deliver that." Sadiq Khan, the Mayor of London, admitted that an increase of 23% in stabbings in London was unacceptable, but blamed cuts to the police force for the increase in crime. Hosting his BBC show, Andrew Marr said, "When you were elected as mayor, you said you were going to bring down violent crime. Since then, violent crime and stabbings have soared." As Mr. Khan tried to dodge the violent crime statistics to say overall crime had risen 4% in 2 years, Mr. Marr interrupted to say, "Stabbings have gone up by 23%. In London, where you are responsible, stabbings are up 23%. Mr. Khan said, "It is not good enough. We have got to make sure we take action. But I will tell you this, what doesn't help is over the last 8 years we have lost over £700 million. Police officer numbers have gone down, and we need the government to help us in this regard, because I am doing my bit in London. We have invested from City Hall £140 million in police, in a new violent crime task force, which is getting NIFs off our streets and making sure we arrest those carrying NIFs." The context is, though, £140 million versus £1 billion worth of cuts and police and crime commissioners, police constables, Home Office civil servants all accept there is a link between a cut in police forces and an increase in crime. I am not excusing criminality, but we need the government to step up and help us. The number of knife crime incidents being investigated by the Met Police has surged in 2018, with more than 51 victims fatally stabbed. The dramatic rise in knife crime in London has received widespread media attention, both domestically and internationally. The US President, Donald Trump, has also drawn attention to the crime rate on social media and in speeches, and even criticized London for being like a war zone. Eric Trump, President Donald Trump, challenged the mayor of London on Saturday, saying Mr. Khan should concentrate on violent crime rates instead of creating tensions between the UK and US by giving permission of the 20-foot Trump baby balloon. Speaking at President Trump's Turnberry golf course before other delegates arrived, he said, "That balloon, letting it fly over the city, What does it do for relations between the two countries? Who can tell me that isn't a foolish thing to let happen? The US and UK are probably the strongest allies in the history of the world. To allow a leader to be disrespected like that, but a mayor of all people, is just not very smart. He then blasted Mr. Khan over rising violent crime in the capital, saying, he should spend more time on his own city than trying to jeopardize international relations with stunts. Look at the crime rates there, they have gone through the roof. What he's done is very sad and very foolish. The angry Trump baby was a focal point of a day of protests in London on Friday, with 250,000 people marching through the capital to declare the US president wasn't welcome in Britain. The balloon, which was made after a crowdfunding campaign raised £18,000, then moved to Edinburgh for protests on Saturday as Mr. Trump moved to his Scottish golf course in Turnberry. Speaking on BBC Radio 4 Today programme, the Tory Remainer claimed the European Union had already worked sensibly with the Prime Minister during the Brexit negotiations so far. But BBC host John Humphreys dismantled her claim, arguing that Brussels would never accept Mrs. May's deal following Monday's amendment to the government's white paper. Mr. Humphreys said, "What now? Is Chequers dead? It has been killed, hasn't it? Because one of the amendments that passed last night, and you weren't able to stop it passing, says that the EU will have to collect duties for us just as we were to collect duties for the EU. There's no way that the EU will do that. So, it has had the effect of killing it, hasn't it?" The Conservative MP for South Cambridgeshire replied, "Well, we hope that the EU are sensible and will continue to work with the Prime Minister as they have been." She was certainly very positive. But the BBC presenter snapped back, claiming it would be naive to believe the EU would ever accept the deal as it stands. He said, "But you don't seriously believe that? Nobody would seriously believe that the EU will start collecting customs duties for this country." Miss Allen admitted Tuesday's amendment to the Brexit trade bill will help in ensuring an appropriate backstop is in place for the EU to be able to consider the Chequers' proposals. She said, "No, but that's one of the reasons we have this amendment today, which essentially, nobody loves the word backstop at the moment, but that's what it would achieve. That if our chances of creating such a deal as the Prime Minister has outlined at Chequers, our thought is if they're now not possible, we're still hoping that they will be. If that should come to pass, the backstop position is still that we stay in a customs union with the EU." Remainer Nick Clegg also argued the EU will be unlikely to accept Theresa May's so-called soft Brexit proposals. He said, "The EU won't accept the Chequers deal, molested by Jacob Rees-Mogg's amendments or not." Mr. Clegg also took direct aim at Mrs. May's customs model, stating, "I know for a fact government negotiates." The blimp is flying above Parliament Square as protesters take to the streets against Mr. Trump's visit to London. The balloon depicts the US president as an angry baby wearing a nappy and holding a mobile phone. As it ascended, the balloon leaned forward and managed to rise about 20 feet above the ground. It appeared unstable as it wobbled over the crowd that had come out to see it. Some on Twitter didn't think the blimp was quite up to scratch. @LeninSF tweeted, "That Trump baby blimp isn't even big, haha, yes, got scammed." @LewisWordley found the whole situation bizarre as he tweeted, "It's actually mad that people are flying a blimp of a Trump baby, ha 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 ha, weirdos." @NickG1000 added, I assumed the pound sign from baby blimp was going be the size of the Hindenburg. 16 pounds K for a party balloon. Hope they kept the receipt. Others found the blimp a bit embarrassing. @EmollyHall Hall tweeted, "It's not really a blimp, is it? More of a balloon." The exaggeration is on the scale of the words used by the man it portrays. All a bit embarrassing. Pound sign from baby blimp. @Hilshiola tweeted, "Fully understand why people wouldn't like Trump, but this is just embarrassing." Pound sign from baby blimp. Tory MP Nicholas Soames was not happy with the Trump baby outside Parliament, tweeting, "The utterly pathetic, pointless, graceless balloon launched in front of a tiny crowd of tourists pound signed idiotic pathos gesture. The blimp is flying in Parliament Square, London, despite Mr. Trump spending no time near the Houses of Parliament today. In fact, he and the First Lady Melania Trump are spending minimal time in the capital, with meetings at Theresa May's country residence Chequers in Buckinghamshire, before moving on to Windsor Castle to meet the Queen this afternoon. Protesters are also taking to the streets in London for a demonstration and rally this afternoon. The balloon depicts the US president as an angry baby wearing a nappy and holding a mobile phone." @Wackade says was outraged over the blimp. She tweeted, "Imagine if the Americans made a baby blimp of the Queen? We'd be outraged. Who's even that stupid to think that Donald Trump is anything more than a figurehead? Show some decorum, please." @Eddie Mackenzie said it wasn't good manners to fly the blimp. He tweeted, "Is it good manners to launch a giant blimp of your guest as a baby in a nappy and with small hands? Agree, manners are important, but let's be consistent and criticize all bad manners." @RNGrimes_ tweeted, "TBH, it's stunts like this that make me realize that Trump is pissing off all of the right people." Trump Baby Blimp's unverified Twitter account, @TrumpBabyBlimp, responded to Darren's tweet saying, "I didn't mean for this to happen, Darren. I just want to go back to my regular life as a normal, everyday Trump Baby Blimp pound sign free Trump Blimp Baby." @FionaMave suggested another blimp should be flown. She tweeted, "Very nice, now what time is Baby Blimp Con being launched?" Nearly 16,000 people signed a petition to seek Mr. Khan's authorization to fly the Trump balloon during his visit. Last week, London Mayor Sadiq Khan approved the protesters' plans to release the balloon, a decision that provoked outcry from former UKIP leader and Mr. Trump supporter Nigel Farage. Mr. Farage ripped into the London mayor last week during his evening LBC radio show, "I think to have allowed this blimp, it's a step too far. Would you have allowed this to happen if it was of Obama? Sadiq, you might not like Mr. Trump, you might not like his style, you might find him very confrontational, and you didn't like the so-called Muslim ban. But Sadiq, where were you when President Obama introduced a total ban on refugees coming from 7 predominantly Muslim countries? I didn't hear the howls of outrage, I didn't see the protests in the streets of London back in 2016. One chimed that Mr. Khan and London are not representative of the entire country. @MG3438 tweeted, "Small-minded Sadiq Khan, who the hell does he think he is? You might be the mayor." Tory MP Tom Trajendat clashed with Labour's Shami Chakrabarty during an extremely heated debate over Brexit. Baroness Chakrabarty suggested the Conservative MP was getting a lot of air time, as she joked they should time how long the panel were taking to answer a question. BBC Any Questions? Host Edward Sturton asked the Conservative MP whether there was a possibility the final Brexit deal could end up not pleasing anybody. Mr. Trajendat had said, "There is always a reality in all negotiations that it is possible that parties don't come to an agreement. Of course, that is true. But The idea that there is only one party talking here is untrue. That is why there is a very important change that is happening in Europe, and one that hasn't been noticed and sadly hasn't been picked up very much by the UK media. That is that the negotiations are now moving from the Commission, from Barnier and his legalistic approach that we have got really rather used to, too used to in my view, over these past years, and is going over to the Council of Ministers. And you're starting to hear very clearly, individual countries expressing their views. This is actually where the negotiations should have started. The truth is, this negotiation is not a legal process. The Labour politicians stepped in claiming there were legal rights at stake in negotiations. Mr. Tugend had quickly replied, "Shami, forgive me. If I can finish my sentence, then perhaps we will get to it." Ms. Chakrabarty then suggested she was not getting an equal amount of time to speak on the show. She said, "Should we measure the time that we have each spoken?" The comments were greeted with some members of the audience applauding and cheering before the Conservative MP delivered a quip. Mr. Tugend had said, "You never have a problem getting yourself heard, Shami." He added, "The truth is, this is going on to becoming a political process where it should have started. The truth is, this is a political discussion between 28 countries, and Brussels authorities should only be acting as curator, not as leader." On Thursday, the government released its white paper, which was criticized by leading Brexit supporters who warned UK could become a vassal state and be forced to accept EU regulations. Officials believe the 98-page blueprint will help guide negotiations going forward, with the ideas of a common rulebook and free trade area ensuring the border remains frictionless. The document reads, "At the core of the UK's proposal is the establishment by the UK and EU of a free trade area for goods. This would avoid friction at the border and ensure both sides meet their commitments to Northern Ireland and Ireland through the overall future relationship." The US president launched an attack on the way Prime Minister Theresa May has negotiated Brexit with the European Union, as he travelled to Britain for an official visit. Speaking after me, BBC's Daily Politics host Joe Kilburn has ripped into the Tory rebel group for losing to the party's Brexiteers in yesterday's votes on Brexit in Parliament. The European Research Group, ERG, led by Jacob Rees-Mogg, managed to secure four crucial amendments yesterday, including one that will scupper the plan for a new customs deal. This has left Remainers in the Conservative Party infuriated, as they prepare for a crunch vote in the Commons that will tie Britain to a customs union after Brexit. The Remainer-backed amendment would force the UK to remain in a customs union with the European Union if negotiators are unable to reach a deal by January 21, 2019. Last night's Commons vote saw Brexiteers narrowly defeat Tory rebels by just 3 votes on 2 amendments. Challenged over the Brexiteers' victory yesterday, Tory rebel Jonathan Janogli denied claims Remainers had lost the party battle over Brexit. This prompted BBC host Kilburn to hit back, as Nadine Dorries said, "The Brexiteers have got the numbers. They are holding sway. You said they threatened to rebel and the Prime Minister backed them. You've been outmaneuvered and your side lost." Mr. Janogli struggled to respond, but claimed that the ERG amendments were small votes that will change before we get to the final deal. Tory Brexiteer Nadine Dorries, who was also in the BBC studio, pointed out, "Why was Salisbury so angry yesterday if these changes were so inconsequential?" Mr. Janogli responded by insisting that Ms. Salisbury's remarks were not intended to attack the ERG, but instead attack the idea of a cliff-edge Brexit. He added that a vast majority of the Tory party supported the Chequers' plan. During a furious rant in the Commons yesterday, Prominent Remainer Toriana Selbry attacked the wealthy in her own party as she demanded frictionless trade must continue with the EU post-Brexit. MPs dubbed the event a lady zoo for Slimeballs. The Charity Commission said it was evident that people of authority thought insufficiently about the welfare of the women hired to work at their charity's event while taking careful steps to protect the privacy of the male guests attending the dinner. Charity officials were attacked for failing to adhere to what was expected in the 21st century. The report found significant failures at the charitable trust and said the trustees were in breach of a number of key charity law duties. It said, the trustees failed fully to recognize or address risks to the reputation of the charity and its purpose of raising money for good causes, arising from holding an all-male event staffed by female-only event staff, who were subject to instructions on their appearance, including that they wear smart, sexy shoes. Helen Stevenson, chief executive of the Charity Commission, said, the allegations made about the event were entirely at odds with what we would expect from any charity when raising funds for such important causes. Our report should serve as a warning to others that raising funds for charity does not absolve trustees of their legal duties or moral responsibilities. Hostesses at the event, who were hired by an agency, were allegedly told to wear black underwear and different color nail varnish if they wanted to stay beyond 2 a.m. for an after-party. A representative for the trustees said, we are also surprised at both the report's muted acknowledgement of the fact that not a single complainant has come forward since the FT's article was published, and at the weight of credibility it gives to the FT's reporting of the 2018 dinner. The core issues investigated by the Charity Commission in coming to its conclusions concern perceptions rather than any proven facts. We, as trustees, have never and would never condone the sort of alleged behavior described in the FT article. The trustees, named on the Charity Commission website as David Meller, Harvey Sinning and Bruce Ritchie, said they would adhere with the action plan in the report. The commission admitted their call for more information did not result in anyone coming forward with allegations of sexual harassment or improper behavior at the event. Remaining funds in the charity will be given to causes such as Great Ormond Street Children's Hospital after the organization was shut down following the Ropers. Cabinet Minister Anne Milton said, words fail me. For over 33 years, HMS Diamond was guided in by three tugboats after suffering the engineering malfunction just a few miles from Devonport. The Type 45 destroyer, which cost more than £1 billion, had already seen a nine-month operation in the Gulf cut short last October after developing a problem with her propeller. According to sources, the latest fault left her without power and she was forced to send an urgent message for assistance. Some sources suggested she sailed back under her own steam and had used the tugs to guide her in. However, witnesses claimed her engines could not be heard. Delivery driver Bernie Ward, 43, said he was having a coffee and watching the ships in Plymouth Sound when he saw HMS Diamond surrounded by tugs late in the afternoon. It was clear that HMS Diamond was under tow. The line to the tug Faithful could clearly be seen as she limped into the dockyard and she had two more tugs assisting her, he said. Something was clearly very wrong. It was clear she had no power. I could not hear any engines and the ship was totally under the control of the tugs. Headed by Commander Ben Keith, the warship had been on standby as the Navy's fleet-ready escort, ready to deploy at short notice to maintain the security of the UK coastline, which can include intercepting Russian vessels in the channel. Only last month HMS Diamond, which was commissioned into the fleet in 2011 and underwent an overhaul in 2016, steamed at high speed into the English Channel to shadow Russian spy ship Yantar. With a 190-strong crew, The air defense destroyers are designed to shield the rest of the fleet from air or missile attack with Sea Viper missiles that can knock down targets at a range of 70 miles. However, the Daring-class destroyers have experienced engineering problems with their unique electrical propulsion system, which have resulted in power blackouts, leaving the ships unable to operate. All six Type 45 seconds have been affected with the power loss, and the Ministry of Defense is planning to replace the current two specialist engines with three more powerful units in a £1 billion overhaul called Power Improvement Project later this year. In the worst incident, Diamond's sister ship HMS Dauntless suffered power problems off the coast of Senegal, West Africa in 2012. When she was reportedly plunged into darkness by a blown fuse. A Royal Navy spokesman said, "The huge shortfall means the worst performing local authorities are failing to collect 10p in every £1 billed." Government figures show £28.3 billion was levied in council tax last year in total. Almost £1 billion of that went uncollected. This was added to £0.55 billion from the previous year and £1.5 billion from before that. The total unpaid council tax debt from households is now £3.02 billion. Birmingham has the biggest tally at £111 million. Leeds, Liverpool, Manchester, Sheffield, and some London boroughs have huge arrears too. By contrast, Retail and Richmondshire, both North Yorkshire, and Rutland, have arrears of under £1 million. A local government association spokesman said, "Council tax has one of the highest collection rates of any tax." With local government in England facing an overall funding gap of almost £8 billion by 2025, councils have little option but to reduce discounts for people. The effect of James Husband's abuse was to leave her enduring a life sentence of suicidal thoughts and self-harming, a court heard. Husband, 68, is the fifth teacher from £34,000-a-year Christ's Hospital School in Horsham, West Sussex, to be convicted of sexually abusing students over a period spanning more than 30 years. The retired schoolmaster, from Wigginton, York, was found guilty last week of one count of rape and five of indecently assaulting a girl from the age of 14 between 1990 and 1993 while he was teaching at the prestigious school. Husband appeared with a co-defendant, Gary Dobby, 67, who was convicted of abusing eight children as young as 12 over 3 years up to 2001. Now retired and a French resident, he will be sentenced at a later date. Husband, known by his middle name Andrew, told the then 16-year-old before the rape, "It's okay, I've had a vasectomy." Judge Christine Henson QC, sentencing him yesterday as well as placing him on the sex offenders register for life and banning him from working with children, said that the victim had given harrowing evidence during the trial at Hove Crown Court. She told Husband, "You put yourself in the position of her mentor in order to make her feel special and dependent on you so you could do what you wanted sexually with her. She viewed you as a father figure, thus rendering the abuse of trust particularly acute." The victim said harrowing the abuse left her with a life sentence of anorexia, suicidal thoughts and self-harm. In an impact statement read to the court, she said, "The grooming process was devious and malignant by making me feel special for the first time in my life. I became dependent on him for my own feeling of self-worth." She said that Husband molded her into his plaything and puppet so he could do what he wanted to me. She added, "He twisted my mind to abuse my body and made my body feel dirty and degraded until I believed this to be true." She said she had been offered a place at Cambridge University but had failed to reach the grades because she had been worn down by his abuse, which had left her with a life sentence of anorexia, suicidal thoughts and self-harm. Being in court for the trial had brought flashbacks to her school days which were unbearable. Aloys Marshall, prosecuting, said that husband targeted the victim as a particularly vulnerable and intelligent pupil. She said, she was a great pupil capable of achieving great things. He lifted her out of the ordinary, giving him the opportunity to sexually assault her. Charlotte Newell, defending, said, he was a great teacher, inspirational to very many students who he taught over very many years. The shame will live with him emotionally and socially for life. During the team, led by manager Gareth Southgate and captain Harry Kane, are due to fly from St. Petersburg to Birmingham today, having lost 2-0 to Belgium in the third-place playoff yesterday. While Football Association FA chiefs are delighted England reached their first World Cup semi-final since 1990, after consulting with Southgate, they have decided against a welcoming home parade for the squad. An FA statement released last night said, following this evening's match, the squad will privately return to England and go their separate ways for a well-earned break. There will therefore be no opportunity for a public reception, either at the airport or elsewhere. The airport also tweeted, there will be no public viewing area to see the England team, so we advise the public not to come. This was met with dismay by many fans on social media. One tweeted, Birmingham Airport, do you really think your tweet will stop fans going to the airport? If they want to go, they will. Another massaged, I'll be there with a coach full of fans. You cannot stop people supporting and congratulating our national team, added another. The fans who traveled to Russia to support England expressed their pride in the team's performances. English teacher Charlotte Dale, 26, from Nottingham, said, the team has really lifted everyone's spirits. Financial analyst James Mills, 23, from Barnsley, said, I don't think anyone expected them to reach a World Cup semi-final. Back home, Sir Geoff Hurst, the 1966 World Cup final hat-trick hero, said, we should be proud of our boys. Psychologist Professor Sir Kerry Cooper, president of the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development, said thanks to the young team and gentlemen manager, people are now talking to their neighbors more and realize this has led to an unacceptable waste of the talents of more than 1 million people over 50 who are unemployed, the report entitled Older People and Employment found. MPs said the government needs to be clearer that prejudice, unconscious bias and casual ageism in the workplace were all unlawful under the Equality Act 2010. Tory committee chairwoman Maria Miller said the lack of enforcement was both alarming and totally unacceptable. The report concluded the employer-led nature of the government's approach was unlikely to present an adequate challenge to discriminatory practices or attitudes. The committee said it wanted to see recruitment agencies accept greater responsibility, collecting data on where older workers are being excluded and developing a plan of action to remove discrimination from the recruitment process. It recommended the reporting of the age profile of workforces following the introduction of gender pay gap reporting to challenge discrimination. The report said, it is unacceptable that the nation is wasting the talents of more than 1 million people aged over 50 who are out of work, but would be willing to work if the right opportunity arose. People in later life are often playing many different roles in society, but those who wish to work should not face the current barriers of discrimination, bias and outdated employment practices. Too little is being done to enforce the law. Mrs. Miller added, age discrimination in the workplace is a serious problem, as many older people have discovered. Yet despite it being unlawful for more than a decade, the scale and lack of enforcement uncovered by our inquiry is both alarming and totally unacceptable. The startling research, released by NHS Digital, follows research which showed almost 30,000 teenagers of both sexes were hospitalized for carrying out acts of self-harm, a rise of over 70% in 5 years. Between 2016 and 2017, a total of 1,077 children aged 12 and under had to go to hospital with damage caused by self-harm, almost double the figure of 552 recorded in 2011-12. The figures on preteens show 809 girls aged 0-12 were hospitalized for self-harm. The figure for 2011-12 was 258. Meanwhile, the number of 13-19-year-olds being hospitalized for self-harm spiraled from 19,278 in 2011 to 27,126 in 2016. Experts say the data reflects a growing mental health epidemic among children struggling with anxiety, depression and addiction. Barnardo's chief executive, Jave Khan, said, "We are sleepwalking into a mental health crisis, and these disturbing new figures show too little is being done too late to help vulnerable children." Tom Matters, campaigns director at mental health charity Young Minds, said, "Too often children don't get help until they reach crisis point. That's why we need increased." Police officers removed the vehicle from Durrington, a village about 2 miles north of Amesbury, on Sunday at approximately 8:30 p.m. Policemen and military officers took the parked van away from a Vaughan Road on a military loader and transported it to the Defence Science and Technology Laboratory at Porton Down, where scientists are carrying out tests. Detectives believe Ms. Sturgis's partner Charlie Rowley, who also fell deeply ill following the contact with Novikok, traveled in the van with three other men within the time frame he may have been contaminated. This operation is part of the murder inquiry triggered by the death of Ms. Sturgis. It reflects investigators' attempts to reconstruct the movements of the victim and Mr. Rowley within the arc of the 24 hours that occurred between the contact with the nerve agent and their illness. The people who shared the vehicle with Mr. Rowley are being kept under observation by doctors, but so far none of them have shown any signs of having been exposed to the nerve agent or feeling unwell, Neil Basu, Britain's most senior counter-terrorism officer, said. Mr. Basu explained how the police's investigation is evolving. He said, "As the investigation progresses, we continue to build on our understanding of their movements, which is key to us establishing when and where Don and Charlie were contaminated." As part of this, detectives had identified a red Ford Transit van that Charlie traveled in as a passenger on Saturday, prior to falling ill. "Yesterday, the military assisted us with transporting the van from a location in Amesbury to the Defence Science and Technology Laboratory at Porton Down. Their scientists will carry out tests on the vehicle. This has been done both as a precautionary measure and to assist investigators in piecing together the facts behind this dreadful incident." Mr. Basu also admitted detectives have been unable to confirm if the Novikok used in the latest incident that took the life of Ms. Sturgis is the same used on the former Spicer Gay Skripal and his daughter, poisoned on March 4th in Salisbury. And he said they could have received a high dose of Novikok when they handled a vessel containing the substance. The grieving mother of Ms. Sturgis said her daughter's partner may soon die too. She said, "It's not looking good for Charlie either. Maybe a few days. He won't pull out of this either. He's just alive with the machines." The couple are believed to have found a vessel containing Novikok in Salisbury's Queen Elizabeth Gardens on Friday, June 29. They were found unconscious 24 hours later in Mr. Rowley's house. and brought to Salzburg. But for so many, the defining image of the match against West Germany on July 4th was that of Paul Gascoigne crying after he was booked and realized he would miss the final through suspension if England were to progress. It was 1-1 at the time in an epic match. On the hour, Andreas Brehm had put the Germans in front, as his free kick hit the England defensive wall and looped over goalkeeper Peter Shilton. But 10 minutes from the end, England drew level through Gary Lineker to take the match into extra time. 8 minutes into the additional period came Gaz's life-changing moment. He was carrying a yellow card after being booked for a foul on Belgium's Enzo Sifo in the quarterfinals, and when he slid into Thomas Berthold, Gascoigne could not believe the outcome. It was his second caution, which meant he would be suspended for the next match. But if that was dramatic, what followed was England's first tournament penalty shootout, with Lineker, Peter Beardsley and David Platt all scoring while Brehm, Lothar Matthaus and Karl-Heinz Riedel converted for Germany. Then up stepped Pierce to see his spa kick saved by Bodo Ilgner, before Olaf Thon put Germany in front. Weddle had to score, but he drove the ball well over the bar and England were out. It was the first penalty Weddle had ever taken at such a level, and he reflected at the time, "The only one I had taken before was for Tottenham in a preseason game. I had watched the goalkeeper very closely and noticed that he dived low. I decided to hit it hard and high. I kicked the post in anger and frustration, and the first player to speak to me was the West German captain Matthaus. He said, 'Don't worry, it's a horrible way to go out of the World Cup.' That was a magnificent gesture." England were captained that night by Terry Butcher, now a Daily Express columnist for this World Cup. This week he looked back on the events of that infamous evening. "We played the best football of the tournament in the 1990 semi-final and stood toe-to-toe with the Germans, and battled them for 2 hours," said Butcher. "We played some lovely football on the night. They had one or two chances, we had one or two chances. There was nothing to choose between the two sides. We played really well. The goal we conceded was a fluke more than anything else, but we changed the system and came back into the game. Then it went to penalties. I was watching from the bench, having been taken off to bring on a more attacking player in the 70th minute. When Gazza was booked, and Gary Lineker said across to the dugout, 'Have a word,' everybody had a word. The whole bench was up shouting and encouraging Gascoigne. 'You miss the penalty, you lose and that's it. But it does not feel like you've lost a semi-final, that does not sink in until days after.' I went over to Gazza, who was in tears, but he had really played well on the night and in the tournament, and I felt sorry for him." Gascoigne, speaking to FIFA's website, said, "When I was a young kid playing at my youth club, every night I used to dream about playing football at the World Cup. I lived that dream in Italy." Butcher said, "As a captain, your job was to try to console players. I knew it was my last World Cup, but I wanted to make sure the other players come back from it. I remember their manager Franz Beckenbauer coming over and being a real gentleman. We could see the Germans celebrating and it was hard. But that is when you have to be strong. Percy was inconsolable, Chrissy Waddle was inconsolable. There is not a lot you can say to them, it just takes them a time to recover. The dressing room was like a morgue. It was the last match of Robson's tenure as manager. It was a football night in Turin like no other. How they lined up West Germany, 3-5-2, Ilgner, Buchwald, Augenthaler, Kohler, Berthold, Hassler, Reuters 66, Matthaus, Thon, Brehm, Klinsmann, Waller, Riedel 38. Booked, Brehm. Goal, Brehm 60. England, 5-3-2, Shilton, Parker, Butcher, Stephen 70, Wright, Walker, Pierce, Waddle, Gascoigne, Platt, Lineker, Beardsley. Booked, Parker, Gascoigne. Goal, Lineker 80. Referee, Jose Roberto Wright, Brazil. Penalty shootout, England, Gary Lineker, goal 1-0, Peter Beardsley, goal 2-1, David Platt, goal 3-2, Stuart Pearce, saved 3-3, Chris Waddle. Andrew Neil dismantled calls for a second Brexit referendum during a hilarious introduction to the This Week program. Mr. Neil took a dig at anti-Brexit figures such as Alistair Campbell and Peer Lord Aidaness over their demands the government should have British voters have a say on the final withdrawal deal agreed to with the European Union. The BBC presenter said, in other news, following England's defeat in the World Cup semi-final, the Prime Minister has insisted that exit means exit and that we are leaving on far better terms than were thought possible even a month ago. Tory Brexit rebels begged to differ, claiming it would have been better if we just crashed out without playing anybody. Mr. Neil continued, Alistair Campbell has called for a rematch with Croatia, claiming the first game was all a big mistake. Andrew Aidaness said it should be the best of three with the option of extra time if it's still not going well for England. He added, and AC Grayling says we should just keep playing Croatia until we get the result he wants. Campaigners for the People's Vote have been calling for a second referendum on Brexit at the end of the negotiations with Brussels. The vote would give British voters a choice between the final deal reached by Theresa May with the bloc and remaining in the European Union. A deal is still yet to be arranged for Brexit amid uncertainty as the Conservative cabinet saw two resignations take place in 24 hours as Boris Johnson and David Davis left their posts. Shortly after the resignations, Mr. Campbell was forced to admit the campaign does not know what question they want the referendum to ask the public. Mr. Campbell said, what the question is, I don't know and I am upfront about that but ultimately it is the only way we can even begin to bring the country back together because I have never seen it so divided after a referendum. Now with Boris Johnson causing more chaos, I think ultimately the people are looking at this and think this is not what we voted for. United Utilities said a temporary use ban affecting 7 million people will come into effect for Northwest England from Sunday, August 5. The announcement follows weeks of blistering heat, with last month ranking as the ninth driest June on record. Temperatures are expected to hit 30°C again by Friday, following a brief respite of heavy downpours on Monday. So far, the hottest day this year was 33°C at Porthmadogan Gwynedd on June 28. Despite United Utilities' decision to introduce a hose pipe, Anglian Water says there's no chance of them following suit in the east of England. An Anglian Water spokesman told express.co.uk, water levels in our reservoirs and groundwater stores are healthy and in some cases above average. Having said that, we're a responsible business, so we're encouraging our customers to be water wise, as we do all year round. Plus, we live in the driest region in the UK and we always need to think about the next summer ahead. The region gets about half the average rainfall of other parts of the country so water efficiency is promoted all year round, the spokesman added. Northumbrian Water, Bristol Water and Thames Water also said they had no plans to introduce a ban. The heatwave is set to last well into August, potentially become a record-breaking spell, said the Met Office. This could prove worrying for vulnerable groups, such as the elderly, and people struggling to cope with the unwavering temperatures. Exacta weather forecaster James Madden said, during the back end of July we expect a return to dominant high pressure and another significant rise in temperatures. We expect this to continue into much of August, particularly in the second half of the month, when there is high confidence summer will end with a monster heat wave. Sticky temperatures will return from Thursday moving into Friday, when the mercury will rise to 30°C. A ban prohibits people from using hose pipes and sprinklers for watering gardens and cars. But you can keep your garden topped up with a watering can or use a bucket and sponge to clean your car. If introduced, a ban can reduce water usage by between. Pro-Brexit MEP Daniel Hennan urged the British government to act firmer during negotiations with the European Union to secure a future trade deal with the bloc. Mr. Hennan claimed the reluctance of British negotiators to recognise the result of the vote had weakened Britain's position at the table. Speaking to Fox News, the British politician said, "If you go into them reluctantly and defensively, wishing that you weren't here at all, wishing that the vote hadn't happened and thinking that success is about salvaging as much as you can of the existing deal, then you put yourself in an incredibly weak position vis-a-vis the EU. What we should do is say, look, we are a global country, we are the fifth largest economy in the world, we're the fourth military power, we have friends and allies on every continent. We are happy. In fact, we are more than happy." Mr. Hennan suggested that reminding Brussels that the UK has other options away from the bloc could push EU negotiators to make concessions towards a new deal. He continued, "We are keen to do a comprehensive free agreement.